You're listening to Fade to Black with your host, Jimmy Church, on the Dark Matter Radio Network. Don't hide. Don't be afraid. Don't turn away any longer. Truth will set you free. And now, your host, the captain of conspiracy, the prince of paranormal. This ain't your daddy's radio network show. This is Jimmy Church, Fade to Black.
Aha! All right. Getting settled in here. Settled in. It's Fade to Black. And I am your host. Today is Wednesday, April 16th. 103 days into the new year. As always, we are live from the JP Motorsports Studios right here in Burbank, California. Not a cloud in the sky. Beautiful day outside. For KJCR and the Dark Matter Radio Network, I am your host, Jimmy Church. And here we go. Wednesday edition. Start off every show the same way. I'm going to do it right now. Proud salute to the men and women in uniform all around the world, fighting the good fight for us. Without them, there is no me, there is no you, there is no us, and you couldn't hear me right now. Think about it. Today, singer Bobby Vinton is 79 years old. Who is Bobby Vinton? Remember that movie, Blue Velvet? That Bobby Vinton. And think about this, because every time I hear Blue Velvet now, I don't care what that song is about. I think about that movie. Somebody said the other day, I can't believe this show, man. I'm not making this up either. Cool show like that, but they do celebrity birthdays. I'm like, man, go do your own show. These birthdays that I announce are part of me. Just to let you know who I am. Our dead guy's birthdays today are singer Jerry Rafferty. Born in 1947, died in 2011. 59 years? Wow. Not very much. Or is that 63? What is that? He sang the hit Baker Street. And we all remember that song, Jerry Rafferty. But check this out. Dusty Springfield, born in 1939, died in 1999. Again, what is that? 60 years. That's kind of weird. Who is Dusty Springfield? Well, check this out. She sang the song Son of a Preacher Man. And you remember that from that scene in Pulp Fiction. Dusty Springfield. Just absolutely crazy. That song was in 1968. She was born in 39. Not that big of a deal, but, you know, just died in 1999. 60 years old. Crazy. Great singer. Great song. Let's move on now that we got that out of the way. Twitter, Facebook, YouTube. Everything is Fade to Black at J Church Radio. You know what to do. And if you're over on Dark Matter Radio right now, just scroll up on that Fade to Black page. All the links are right there. Go follow, like, and subscribe if you're at J Church Radio. Or if you're on the website, Jimmy Church Radio, you can do that there too. It's all right in front of you. I think one of these days we're going to have a Twitter telethon. We're going to see how many tweeters we can get to a like in one day. We'll see. Go follow us on Twitter at J Church Radio tonight. Stuart Robbins, the famous Dr. Stu, will be with us. I'll talk more about that in a second. I will have open lines later on, 323-825-5045. You can email throughout the show. all of our fabulous people that write in every single day. You know what to do. Pierce the veil of the producers here at the show. I can see now emails are already stacking up. It's going to be a crazy show. The show is done for you to come in here and learn. You give me 2-3 hours of your day, and I appreciate it more than anything. And tonight's going to be one of those nights. You will walk away a learned person. Email Jimmy at JimmyChurchRadio.com. You can also do it in confidence on the website. Got any questions for Stu? And you will. Make it good. Stu's a smart guy. All right. Let's see here. A couple of things. I'm going to talk about this after the break a little bit, but I hope you saw the blood moon 2 nights ago. Stunning. Took my breath away, and I hope you saw it, and we'll talk about that. Tonight, Stuart Robbins. Stuart Robbins has got a very popular podcast called PseudoAstro. And if you haven't had the chance or didn't know or hadn't discovered this brilliant, brilliant podcast, then you need to go and check that out. The links are up at JimmyChurchRadio.com. And so go after this show tonight. There's your homework for the next couple of weeks. Go get caught up. And we're going to be talking about a lot of the stuff that is on that podcast. And so throughout our discussion tonight, make some notes, take out a pen, and then go back to his website. Excuse me. Go back to his website and listen. I'm very, very, very excited about having Stuart on. And a little disclaimer, just let me say this. All of my friends out there, just listen. You know that old Uncle Jimmy here is on both sides of a lot of fences. I swing from both trees. I really do. There are things out there that I'm fascinated with, that I'm outspoken about. And we all know how I feel about Göbekli Tepe and Giza and Mayans and the Chinese and the old history of the United Kingdom and here in the United States. Fascinating subjects. One that we need proof on. Göbekli Tepe has helped us out with that. Certainly has. But then there's the other side of stuff. We all know, I believe, that we've been visited. We're visited probably all the time. But then there's the guys out there that try to force stuff on you based on fact and science. And a lot of it is incorrect, which turns it into lies. And that I'm not comfortable with. And that's why a lot of those guys have not been guests on this show. People ask me all the time, hey, Jimmy, what about this guy? What about this guy? What about this guy? What do you think about this guy? Well, this girl. And yeah, I've had controversial guests on this show. But there are certain guests, or there wouldn't be guests, certain people out there that won't be guests on this show. Why? Because this show is based on truth. That's it. And if I have somebody on the show that is not spewing the truth and can't convince me of that, then if they were on the show, then how am I presenting myself and this show to the listeners? It's very important. I'm not going to lie, and I'm not going to fake my way through something. I'm not going to act like I'm interested in something that I'm not. And it's a disservice, and it's not fair. So that's why those types of guests aren't on this show. They can go somewhere else. That's fine. But on this show, the reason why you are here is because you believe in me. That's why. And you expect certain standards on this show and credibility and integrity. Okay? It's that simple. I'm a cool guy. I'm an open-minded guy. But I also base everything on the truth. And that's me. And it will always be that way. Hence, our guest tonight, Stuart Robbins. Stuart is fascinating. I spend a lot of time listening to his show. And in a lot of ways, when things get whacked out of my, in my brain, Stuart brings me back to earth. And I'm very excited about having him on tonight. So with that, I'm going to take a break and come back with the news, as always. We've got a few other things that we need to talk about and cover tonight. But Stuart Robbins for the next two and a half hours until he can't take it anymore. Shoot us an email right now to jimmy@jimmychurchradio.com. Follow us on Twitter @JChurchRadio. This is Fade to Black. I'm your host, Jimmy Church, the Wednesday edition. I'll be back right after this. Don't touch that mouse.
Listening to Jimmy Church Fade to Black on the Dark Matter Radio Network.
What's up, revolutionaries? It's me, Jimmy Church. Do you have an IRS or state tax issue? Well, I did, and I called national tax experts. My problems were fixed, done, fini, and man, I gotta tell you, it was a relief. National Tax Experts are a recognized tax office that services clients in all 50 states. It doesn't matter where you live. Give them a call. I'm telling you, they take the time to understand each and every client's individual financial status as well as their financial goals. And that's exactly what you need, my brother, when you're taking on the evil three-letter. So, seriously, give them a call today at 1-877-909-5444. Again, 1-877-909-5444, or go check out their website, www.nattaxexperts.com. That's NATTAXEXPERTS.com. Tell them Jimmy sent you.
This is KJCR at JimmyChurchRadio.com
on the Dark Matter Radio Network.
All right. Oh, lights are down. Studio's dark. It is Wednesday. This is Fade to Black. Man, so good to be here. To everybody out there listening around the world, across the United States, everywhere, thank you. I am so humbled. Just got this email. Man, good thing it's Wednesday. Starting to feel a little itchy. I need my Fade to Black fix. It came in from Brad. I'm with you, Brad. All right. Good to be back. Okay. In a little bit, we'll have Stuart Robbins in here. Let's go through some of the news here. Check this out. Lead story of the day, and it has been for 30, 35, 40 days. But this is the lead story now. This is the headline. My version. Pings are gone. Plane is gone. Debris is gone. Boats and planes are still searching. The end. My thoughts? They got what they wanted. Whoever they is. They prolonged it. They procrastinated. They goofed off. They lied to each other. They withheld information between countries. Put it off. Till those batteries wore down. And now they've gotten what they asked for. We'll never know. That thing has gone the way of the Titanic. It's sitting 15,000 feet below. We don't even know if it is. But if that is the case, 15,000 feet down. Well, at least that's where they're searching now. It could be anywhere. But we will truly never know. and they got what they wanted. Now it's off the headlines. It's off of everybody's radar. It's what they wanted. A couple of weeks, it won't be talked about at all. Sad, isn't it? The Tetrad kicked off two nights ago, the Blood Moon. And I just wanted to say this. I know that I got a bunch of email. I had sent out, you know, what did you see? What are you seeing? And the responses that I got, I didn't get anything from outside the United States, which I thought was funny. Well, maybe Canada, a couple from Canada. But and I guess that maybe it was best viewed here in North America at that time, the line. We'll talk to Stuart about it. He probably knows more about this than I do, but maybe that's the case. But I'll say this, man, from Burbank, that baby was red. I couldn't believe it. And the crazy thing for me was looking out and seeing the normal moon nice and bright. And then about an hour later, took a look up in the sky, and that thing was red. And it moved me in a way that I found strange. And I hope that it, you know, that you were able to view it, because we are so acclimated as humans to the sun coming up in the morning, going down in the evening, the moon. There's certain things that your mind, your body, your DNA down to your very core it's acclimated and used to seeing. That's it. Well, my brain wasn't ready for that. You looked up, and it didn't look quite real. That's how it hit me. It looked almost like a puppet in a puppet show, where a puppet is, you know, it's not a real thing. Well, they kind of hit me like that. Just looking up, and it was just so majestic, but the way it was just kind of suspended in red, and the way the atmosphere was lighting up around it just made it look a little spookier. It was unbelievably cool. Now, we're going to get to see three more of these. We are really lucky. Cut into roughly six-month intervals. First one was April 15th. The next one's going to be October 8th of this year. My birthday, by the way, is October 10th. Dang, man. Could have been cool if they could have stretched that out for a couple of days somehow. But October 8th, 2014, then April 4th, again, about a year from today, a little short of that, in 2015, and then again, September 28th, 2015. And if it's anything like, I was talking to Stuart about this before the show, and growing up, I'm not that old. I'm old, but I'm not that old. But saying things like, man, it's a crap, I've never seen anything like it. Well, it's because everything, and I know everybody's going to agree with this. Every time there's anything like this built up, it's just a big letdown. You can't see the eclipse. You're in the wrong spot. It's cloudy. That, you know, whatever. You can't look at it. You got to look through a pinhole. You got to do that. You know, whatever. But that wasn't the case on Tuesday night. Monday night, Tuesday morning. That thing was right there for the world to see. It was insane. Loved it. Nothing kooky kicked off. Remember, I was reading the eclipses from last week. Nothing went down. Okay, a little sad news to report. This was on rawstory.com. I got the news on this a while ago, but we couldn't broadcast until tonight. But our friend, the conspiracy theorist Mike Rupert, shot and killed himself Sunday night after recording his Lifeboat Hour radio show. And apparently, his death was announced Monday night in Facebook. It's weird how that happens these days. It seems like Facebook is the announcing medium. But it was by a post by author Carolyn Baker. And she said in the post that the suicide was not fake, which I thought was a weird way to put it. But considering what Mike broadcasted about over the years, very loudly, very smartly, smart guy, that it wasn't, she didn't want any conspiracy type stuff tied to this, in that apparently Mike had planned the whole thing out and left instructions for his production staff and his friends how to carry on without him. And it was done. He did his last broadcast and then shot himself. And Carolyn, this is a quote from her. She said it was very well planned by Mike, who gave us a few clues but elaborate instructions for how to proceed without him. And she was the guest on his final program. And how crazy is that? And she is going to continue on, or at least the next broadcast will be done by her. Very sad. Mike Rupert. You may remember him from a documentary that I have seen a few times, actually, my wife and I. It's called Peak Oil. If you ever get a chance, go check it out. You probably have seen it. It's called Peak Oil. And before that documentary, I was sort of familiar with the term peak oil. Didn't know really what it meant. But I really liked that documentary. And that was Mike Rupert. And he is no longer with us. Sad, sad story. Okay, what else we got here? Oh, this is great. The most haunted island in the world is up for sale. This comes from Telegraph over in the UK. Now, over in Venice, Italy, you may remember this from Ghost Adventures show with Zach Bagans. By the way, if anybody knows Zach, anybody knows how to get a hold of Mr. Bagans, please contact me. Been trying to reach out to Zach for a while now, and I've gotten close. He's gotten too famous, I guess. But I would like to get him on this show. If anybody knows how to get a hold of Zach, please get a hold of me. But on one of the Ghost Adventures show, they went to this island. It's called Paveglia. Now, this island sits off the coast of Venice. And what's crazy about it, it has been shut down and locked down since about 1968. They had a hospital there. But before that, the plague and a bunch of other stuff that was going down in the early 18th century, 19th century, the island was isolated. They had a boat or two. Again, this is just my memory, that had plague on it, I believe. And so they left the boats out there, left everybody that was on the boats, left them on the island, and then everybody else that got sick in and around Venice got sent to this island, and everybody was left to die. Well, it is truly a spooky place. And when I had found out that it was for sale, man, I'd love to buy it, but I found out it was for sale, and I just remember how spooky and crazy and haunted that island really, truly is. You want to go to a real haunted place, that's the place to go. Not the graveyard in your town. It doesn't matter. Not the insane asylum that sits outside of your city. That's nothing. This is the real deal. Dracula's castle has got nothing on Paveglia Island. So it's up for sale. You need to go and check it out. I don't know if we have the links up on the website right now. We tried to get to it right before the show. But go check that out. All right, next up. Almost forgot. Did you see, if you go over to the Black Vault, blackvault.com, there's a picture. We'll see if we can get it up on jimmychurchradio.com. There's a picture of this black, a giant black ring over in England. It was shot by this 16-year-old girl with her cell phone. And when you look at the picture, it looks exactly like Rex Heflin had shot in his picture back in the 50s. And 50s, 60s. When did Rex shoot those now? I can't remember. It's the exact same black ring. And when you look at the picture, if you didn't know better, you would think it was the original Rex Heflin photo. It looks exactly the same. It was over Lymington Spa in Warwickshire. And this is the thing. This is what makes it real. Okay, this is the quote from the 16-year-old girl. And this is the only reason why I'm speaking about it, besides Rex Heflin, the similarity, is this quote. She says, and I quote here, "I looked up at it and I thought, what the hell?" She says, "It was amazing. It was just floating there like a cloud, and then it disappeared. It wasn't birds either," end quote. That makes it real. She shot something, and it is a crazy, it looks exactly like the Rex Heflin photos. Tonight, we're going to be dropping some names. I'll try to keep the names out of tonight's subject matter with Stuart Robbins. You will know who we are talking about. But before we get to that, I've got a few minutes here, and I was hoping that I would have some time. Over on BuzzFeed today, and I caught this last night, actually, and it was still up today. But over on BuzzFeed, I saw this headline. You got to love this kind of stuff. And I posted around the web about this. But this is the headline. "The 57 best conspiracy theories I heard at New Jersey's 55th annual UFO conference." And it was posted by Katie Haney. Katie, I hope you still like me after I read all of this. "The 57 best conspiracies that she heard." Okay, so we got 4 minutes until Stuart Robbins. I'm going to get as many of these in as I can, but they're fantastically fantastic. Number 57, "The CIA controls the New York Times, the Washington Post, and other leading newspapers." 56, "David Rockefeller put every president from Ford onward into the White House." 55, "The Aspen Institute is the open Bilderberg." CERN, this is number 54, "CERN, the European Organization for Nuclear Research, has a logo that looks like 666. 53, "They are trying to recreate the Big Bang. 52, "We are placated by the NFL and also Dancing with the Stars." Why not The Voice? "Soon, 3D printing will be able to print a 3D being." 50, "The biblical flood took place in 2400 BC. Number 49, "English occultist Aleister Crowley led the demon lamb into our world through an interdimensional portal via a satanic ritual." 48, "Later, Crowley's portal, located at Area 51, was enlarged by rocket scientists Jack Parsons and L. Ron Hubbard. This began the modern UFO era." 47, "This is not the same interdimensional portal that was located on the top of the Tower of Babel, but they are related." 46, "The earth is roamed by shadow people who only leave in the name of Jesus." 45, "Millions of people in the U.S. today worship Lucifer." I don't know one, by the way. Millions. Not one. 44, "One-third of heavenly angels fell with Lucifer and became demons. These demons are getting onto earth via interdimensional portals." Number 43, "Demons dress up in bio suits." Number 42, "Fallen angels mated with humans once, not once, but twice. This information is presented on a PowerPoint slide, the five reasons why I do not believe that there's a second incursion of fallen angels." 41, "Zeus was not an angel." Number 40, "Goliath was a descendant of Zeus." 39, "The Garden of Eden was located in Göbekli Tepe." I'm going to bounce on down. I'll read the rest later. Shoot me an email if you want to hear the rest of this. I got to get to Stuart Robbins. But here we go. Number 14, "Under the Sphinx is the Hall of Records that details the history of the lost continents of Atlantis." MIT, this is 12, "MIT is a front. So is Silicon Valley." Number 11, "The highest levels of the United Nations are in talks to expand the human population out into exo-civilization." Of course they are. Number 10, most of California and the East Coast will be gone by 2137, according to a time traveler who'd been there. Let's jump up to number 8. We first landed on the moon in 1962. Number 7, we landed on Mars in 1966. Number 6, our moon is too perfect a position not to have been deliberately placed there. Number 5, Apollo 17 had a secret mission, but we don't know what it was. Number 4, there's a civilization on the other side of the moon that influences everything we do here on Earth. Number 3, a man named Daryl Anka, who I will have on this show, by the way, can channel an alien friend from the future called Bashar, and you've heard me talk about Bashar enough, who is kind of a self-help guru. Number 2, there are 3 or more spaceships currently parked in Saturn's rings. One is 31,000 miles long. And the number 1 conspiracy theory at the New Jersey UFO. Number 1, at 14 years old, a boy named Ted Rice was abducted along with a girl in his class by aliens who performed heart energy surgery to put some of his heart into the girl's heart. Your hearts are now merged, said the alien, said Ted. He fell head over heels for the girl, but unfortunately, because the aliens didn't put his energy into her soul, and definitely not for any other reasons, she didn't love him back. This is actually what has been going on with one of my one-sided crushes as well, and that according to Carrie. So there you go. Let's take a quick break. When I come back, you know what's going on. Stuart Robbins, live in the studio. This is Fade to Black. I'm your host, Jimmy Church. KJCR and the Dark Matter Radio Network. Email Jimmy at JimmyChurchRadio.com. Twitter at JChurchRadio. Taking a break. Be right back.
Way out here, we listen to Jimmy Church on the Dark Matter Radio Network.
Dark Matter.
Dark Matter.
Dark Matter.
Dark Matter. Dark Matter.
You're listening to Fade to Black
on the Dark Matter Radio Network.
¿Qué tal, mis amigos? Yo soy Mario Carson, el Tiburón, y los invito para que escuchen a mi buen amigo Jimmy Church Radio. ¡Claro que sí!
Oi, oi, I'm Reese Evans. You're listening to Jimmy Church. This is Revolution. The Revolution will not be televised. The Revolution is on radio. Ciao.
All right, everybody, welcome back. KJCR, Fade to Black on the Dark Matter Radio Network. I'm your host, Jimmy Church. Email Jimmy at JimmyChurchRadio.com. Follow us on Twitter at JChurchRadio. I would like to welcome to the program. Let's get the announcing going now. Okay. Stuart Robbins is a PhD geophysicist who earned his PhD studying impact craters on Mars. His research has branched out to studying craters on other objects in the solar system, dynamical simulations of Saturn's rings, and the planning observations for the New Horizons spacecraft when it gets to Pluto in early July 2015. He's taught classes on imaging through telescopes, as a semi-pro photographer, has also given seminars on imaging and anomalies. Many astronomical claims by people probably familiar to many of us on Fade to Black and the Dark Matter Radio Network, such people as, well, let's just drop names, Richard Hoagland, David Sirita, John Lear, and others. His main outlet is his blog and podcast, both called Exposing PseudoAstronomy. I'd like to welcome to the program right now Dr. Stuart Robbins. Stuart, are you with us, sir?
I think so. Can you hear me?
We can hear you just fine. We had a little audio glitch during the commercial break, so that's what that was. Welcome
for some
to
reason, it rang on my iPod, but not on my computer. I don't know why.
You should know these things, good doctor.
My degree isn't in computer science or Skype.
Now, I start off the show the same way. It's funny with these very words that I'm speaking at this very moment. Start everything off the same way, which is, Stuart, this is just a free-form conversation. We're going to sit here like we're sitting in my living room. I have no questions. There's no premeditation. That's my disclaimer. If you and I find this conversation interesting, then so will everybody else. And we'll see where it ends, and hopefully we'll still be friends. Are you ready to go?
Is the cognac out?
Yeah, well, here at Starbucks.
Okay.
You know, I had John Anthony West, right?
I know of him, yeah.
Right. So I had him as a guest on the show. You've got to go if you ever get a chance. Go and listen to the John Anthony West broadcast, because you can hear the clinking of the vodka glass with the ice in it during the show. And it's just fascinating. And every broadcast he's ever done, any interview, it's the same. You know, he's got a method. He's got an MOD. There's just a way that he does things, and it involves vodka, and it's sensational. But no, here at Starbucks. So, but if you want to do cognac, go ahead.
No, I have water and a chocolate bar next to me.
So,
I already had my caffeine. If I drink too much, then I'll just be talking, and you'll never get me to shut up.
I had said during the intro about your excellent, excellent, excellent podcast, and I'm not kissing up to you. It's just, you know, it's just a well done thing, and it's presented in a manner. Not unlike, and I'm sure you've heard this before, but I'll say it now, and I've never discussed this with you, but not unlike what you would hear on NPR. You know, I think it's a very unbiased, it's well-produced, it's very easy to listen to, and it's just done in a manner that everybody can swallow it and digest it. You don't have to be, you know, a PhD to listen to that, even though you do at times bombard with information that even for, you know, a guy like me, it kind of, you know, but most of the time it is very well thought out. And this is probably the only softball question that I'm going to throw out there at you tonight, but what gave you the idea and how did you, there was something out there that stirred you enough that you were compelled to do that program. What happened?
Well, I had started my blog 3 years before I started the podcast back in 2008, and perhaps it might be better to talk about what spurred me to that. And it was, it got back to what I was doing for my PhD, which was identifying and then doing stuff with all these craters on Mars. And that meant that I basically sat in front of a computer all day and literally drew circles tracing out crater rims. And so I got really bored really fast, and I remembered this weird late-night paranormal radio show that I had listened to one time when Phil Plait was on debating Nancy Leader about whether Planet X was going to kill us in May of 2003. And I also remembered the Fox, what I call docudrama, back in the late 1990s about the Apollo moon hoax. And I sort of did some searching, and I found all these podcasts on the paranormal side and on the skeptic and science side, and I just started listening to those while I was drawing circles. And I thought that there was something missing, and that there's a niche in every science where you reach a level of education and just experience that people who don't study it don't have. And I thought that I was listening to one podcast that was great on the medical side and another one that was great on the archaeology side, but I didn't see anything that was astronomy, that was approaching sort of these, I hate to use the term paranormal with this because it's hard to say that with astronomy stuff, but this sort of alternative side with astronomy. And I thought that, well, with my background, all the years of physics classes I took and astronomy classes, maybe I could offer something. And so I started my blog. And as a graduate student, you just don't really have time to spend 10 hours a week doing a podcast. So it was pretty much right after I graduated in May of 2011 that I started up the podcast in August of that year. So it was sort of the same thing. Was I thought that it would be an interesting thing to do. I've always sort of liked the education and public outreach stuff, and I thought that it was sort of a niche field. And I also thought that you could learn something. I could learn something, and people who listened to the podcast or read the show notes or the transcripts, whatever, they can also learn something, because I always found that you learn better by making mistakes and then figuring out why you were wrong than by getting it right the first time or right for the wrong reasons. And so I thought that, well, maybe by delving into why there isn't a planet X that goes around the sun every 360 or 3,600 years on this highly elliptical orbit, why that can't exist in our solar system. I thought that maybe by going through stuff like that, I could learn some stuff, and the audience can also learn some stuff, and you start to assuage some fear by some people, because that was still back in the whole Mayan apocalypse 2012 thing. It was about a year and a half before I started, or I started podcasting about a year and a half before that thing. So I got a lot of hits because of that stuff. So I guess that was sort of a long-winded way of answering the softball.
Well, no, that's fine. Have you ever had to dumb it down? You know, because to me, you're right on the edge of being, you know, almost too technically comprehensive, if you know what I'm saying. And then, you know what I mean? You're right there. So do you have to dumb it down for the rest of us?
I don't think so. I mean, I sometimes explain things more than I would if I were talking to a colleague, but no more so than if I were giving a public open house at an observatory or giving a planetarium talk or anything like that. I have gotten a little bit of feedback on the podcast saying this is way too technical. I have no idea what you're talking about. And my response has always been, well, what did I say that was too technical, too complicated that you didn't understand? Let me know, and I will explain it next time in the feedback in a different way. And so I have had a few times where someone has said, I didn't understand this, can you go over it again? Like when I had an interview with Robin Knupp, one of the researchers on the forefront of the big splash formation theory for the moon's formation, I had her on talking about why we think that that's probably how the moon formed. And I got a few people saying, I had no idea what you guys were talking about with oxygen isotope ratios,
right, right,
et cetera, et cetera. Can you explain it? And so in the next episode, in the feedback, I went over for about 5 minutes discussing why oxygen isotopes are important, what they are, and how they're used. And so, yeah, I mean, one thing when
I just have to jump in really quick. That was an excellent show, by the way. But I came away from that actually disagreeing with you, in that I for some reason I feel that the moon is a piece of the Earth. That's what I think. I think there was some crazy collision and things just rounded out with gravity as time went by. You know, I'm talking about the moon and the Earth, you know, just reformed. But that's what I think. So,
well, that's sort of what the big splash is. It's that another object came in, collided with Earth, and that the moon's material, or the moon today, is formed by a combination of the proto-Earth and that incoming object.
Right. And what do you think? But I want to back in that show. You presented three different versions of how the moon. You know what? Let's forget about it. Let's move on. There's other okay. stuff to talk about. What do you, when you look at Nibiru from the, you present one side of it. Have you ever thought about researching on how maybe it could be there? It's easy to research. I don't, that whole Anunnaki version of things, to me, just wasn't there in the clay tablets, and it's been misrepresented. That, and we can talk about that later. Have you ever thought about trying to research how it could actually be there instead of just proving that how it could not be there?
Well, we sort of know how it could be there. It could be just way, way out there. I mean, the problem is that Nibiru and Planet X are interchangeable terms these days in a lot of fields, and you really have to be careful with that because Nibiru, I think, came from Zachariah Sitchin, and he had a very specific idea for what Planet X would be, whereas on my podcast, I've done, I think, 8 different renditions of what different people say this mystery Planet X is. And we know that there could be a planet out there, and it's just so far away, so far beyond Pluto, that we just don't have the technology to find it yet. And you know, there are all-sky astronomy surveys that have looked for, or where people have looked in the data for that kind of object. And they keep looking and they keep finding, or they keep placing more and more limits on what it could actually be. I think the latest was from the WISE survey, and I'm not even going to try to remember what that stands for, but it's sort of an all-sky infrared survey that is very sensitive, much more sensitive than the previous infrared surveys. And the reason that we like to look for this stuff in infrared is because if it's warm, it's usually going to emit a lot of light in the infrared. So a Planet X would probably be much more visible in the infrared than in visible light. So we've actually looked and they didn't find anything. And now the WISE survey is only sensitive to a certain brightness. So it's just, okay, we've now placed another limit on what a Planet X out there could be. But it's sort of, in my podcast, I try to, I hate to use the term argue, but I will, just for lack of a
That's
more
fine. That's fine.
Simple
that's
term. Fine. I like to argue against what has been presented. In other words, I hear a claim and I'm like, well, that's just silly. And so then I go and investigate and I try to figure out, could it be possible? First, is the claim valid and is there any legitimacy to it? And then what could it be explained by? And with the Planet X stuff, the various lines of evidence that people have suggested, I mean, you just mentioned the Sumerian tablets. I mean, that, well, so those just really come from one translation by one person as opposed to what everyone else who's translated them says that actually says. And I think Michael Heiser would be a much better person to address that than I.
Yes.
But it's just, you have one person saying one thing, and then you have the entire rest of the archaeological community who studies that saying something else. And then you have the entire astronomical community saying, well, a Planet X that comes in every 3,600 years would have to pass through the inner solar system twice every 3,600 years. That's at least 3, 4, 5 times since humanity has been looking up and trying to record stuff. And no civilization has really recorded a giant planet passing close by. And then you say, well, it would also have to pass through or close to or nearby the asteroid belt. And the asteroid belt doesn't display any sort of perturbation by a massive Jupiter, even Saturn, even Uranus-sized planet passing nearby or through it. And if this thing had been coming through twice, because it goes once in and once out, so twice every 3,600 years, for the entire history of the solar system, I mean, the asteroid belt shouldn't
exist
anymore.
Yeah, that's right.
I mean,
that's right.
Well, the thing I like to say is it's dynamically stable. We see that these things are in their nice orbits. We see families of asteroids that go together that have been around for hundreds of thousands of years. And so that's why I'm just like, no, in this case, that particular idea of Planet X doesn't hold weight.
There's one, you can forget about all of the science, in my opinion. You can forget about all of the radio telescopes that are pointing out to the heavens and searching for anything that's, you know, that they can name and identify and track and plot and orbit. You can do that. Throw all of that out the window. But there's one point that makes everything valid that you just touched upon. We have had, for generations and for thousands of years, very intelligent people doing nothing but stare at the night sky. That's all they, that's their gig. And we cannot discount the knowledge of not only, you know, the Egyptians, but the Chinese and the Mayans and Northern Europe and just everywhere. They knew every constellation, every star, every zodiac, anything that was going on, they knew. The wobble of the earth was calculated into their stuff. And for them not to have noticed a rogue planet is crazy. Not once has it been documented by anybody. And that to me is about as much proof as you need, because they know as much as just about what we know today. They knew then, and not much less.
I might quibble a little bit with not much less or not much more, but yeah, I mean, they knew. I mean, what did they do at night? They didn't really have that much to do. So
that's my point.
They recorded the skies very, very well and knew about precession and this other kinds of stuff.
Yes. And when I say not much less, look, we didn't know much more until we got Hubble out there, if you really think about it. And I would say
with the invention of the telescope and the perfection of it, or the successive iterations of it, especially throughout the 1800s and 1900s.
Bingo.
Hubble opened a huge amount, especially the space age, because a lot of the universe is actually invisible to us on the ground because our atmosphere, unfortunately, screens out a lot of ultraviolet and a lot of infrared light. And therefore, infrared and ultraviolet astronomy, you kind of have to do from space or a really, really, really high elevation. And so the dawn of the space age really let us put the ultraviolet and the infrared telescopes up in space. And if I could go back a moment to the Planet X stuff, I'm sort of watching the Twitter feed, and someone raised the issue of the 1983 Washington Post article.
I'm reading that right now, too, yeah.
Yeah, a lot of people point to that and say, well, IRAS, which is the infrared infrared all sky survey or whatever. It was done in the 1980s, and it was this, one of the first all sky infrared surveys, and it looked for this stuff. And a lot of people point to this Washington Post article from December of 1983 as proof that we actually did discover Planet X, and then everyone's been silent ever since then. And if you actually read the Washington Post article, it says, and I quote, "So mysterious is the object that astronomers do not know if it is a planet, a giant comet, a nearby protostar," and then it goes on. And the thing is that people leave out those other stuff. It's a heavenly body possibly as large as the giant planet Jupiter and possibly so close to Earth that it would be part of this solar system has been found. And it's like, that's what they go with. But what people don't realize is that every single one of those point sources identified by IRAS that people didn't know what they were and thought, okay, maybe this could be a planet or it could be these other things, they were all followed up with very detailed, very careful ground-based observations from high-altitude telescopes, and they were found to be distant galaxies. They were not found to be planets. And there are papers that talk about all of these point sources. The problem is, that's not a headline grabber. And so if you're going for your Planet X stuff based on headlines, yeah, okay, in 1983, there's this headline that says, okay, maybe we found a Planet X, but then they don't do all the follow-up work. And so that's actually, I addressed that in podcast episode 54 for people who might want to actually follow up on that.
I want to back up since we're looking at the Twitter feed, and we would be doing a real disservice if we didn't touch upon this, but, Bart Seibel, okay. He was a guest on the show. Now, let me explain to you, because I don't know if you went back and, or did you listen to that broadcast?
I did.
Okay, good. So you know how I found Bart. I found Bart through a really strange, crazy Stanley Kubrick period where I was just trying to find. I had heard all of these rumors, not about Kubrick and Apollo, but hidden messages in Kubrick's films, of which I own all of them, and I've watched them way too often to this day. Some of the best filmmaking out there, period. But that's how I stumbled upon Bart. And then when you get into that rabbit hole and you get sucked into that, everything else kind of falls, you know, with that. Not only the Apollo hoax, but all of the hidden messages, or did Kubrick film the Apollo hoax? Who was involved with it? How far did it go back? Was Kennedy, you know, it's a crazy world of conspiracy out there. But also then you get into the technical stuff. the asteroid belt, Van Allen belt, radiation, the suits, you've got the photography and it's a crazy amount of information that gets all just from Stanley Kubrick. That's all I was doing. It was innocent. But after reading Bart's stuff and starting getting into it and looking back, because I remember watching the first moon landings live, I was young, but I did, that there could be something to this. I don't know if this is as extreme as we went to the moon or not, or were they just not telling us the truth about a bunch of facts? Maybe we did go and didn't walk on the moon. I don't know. But the more that you dive into it, the biggest question I have is technology. Were we technically able to get there? That's what my concern is, not everything else. And Bart, he's got his view. And his view is one that he has researched and he's checked it out and he believes in his view. That's why he was on the show. I wanted to know why he believed in what he believed. And because I'm having questions myself. It's like questioning your faith one day. You're just like, oh, I don't know. I don't know. My faith is weird. I don't know. Well, it's kind of like that with me with the Apollo hoax. So I know that you've got your view on Bart, but do you agree? Would you have Bart on your podcast? Let me ask you that for the very same reasons.
No, and I say that with the same that's the same answer I would give to would I have anyone on the podcast that really has the alternative view, and that's because that's not the purpose of my podcast. The purpose of my podcast is to present the science, and just as I wouldn't have Richard Hoagland on to talk about his stuff, I wouldn't have Bart Sibrel on. It's not that, and I want to make sure that people realize this right up front, is what I try to do is to not in any way, shape, or form attack the person. Because as soon as you do that, you're no longer addressing the claim. You're saying, oh, well, he's just an idiot.
Right.
And that doesn't help anything. And, I've had a lot of people say that about me, and I'm just like, fine, what do you think about my argument? Like, move on, move past that onto the actual argument. Yeah. And I don't think that any of the evidence that Bart Sibrel presents is that convincing. And I say that by also with the caveat that there are a few claims that he's made that I simply have not had time to investigate and don't know the actual answer to. For example, he focused a lot on the talk now, I think, with the moon in front of something and a hand going by or something like that. And he said that the CIA was telling Armstrong to talk now because it had been 2 seconds and that's the light time return. And I just don't know anything about that clip, so I haven't investigated it. But with the technology stuff, to me that just it doesn't hold water. And that's because I've talked about the Apollo moon hoax a lot in planetarium shows, and the example I give is a watch. And today, I mean, like, I'm talking to you through my computer, and I have like 7 different clocks all surrounding me on various devices, and they all sync with the atomic clock. That's a half hour drive from me in Boulder, Colorado at NIST. Mm-hmm. And that's how we tell time today, is that we have an atomic clock and everything syncs with that. That doesn't mean that we have to have an atomic clock to tell time. We've been able to tell time with mechanical wristwatches for a few hundred years, really, really well. In fact, there's a great book out that sounds incredibly boring. It's about how we figured out how to tell longitude. And it goes into the discovery, the various ways to tell longitude on Earth with watching Jupiter's moons or getting very accurate watches. And we've been able to tell time with mechanical watches for hundreds of years. But we don't even need that. We could use water clocks or dial. Yeah, it is sand dial. Okay, whatever. But they're also sundials. Mm-hmm. All of those techniques have been around for thousands of years. And so my point is, all because if we go to the moon today, it's going to require a lot more money, a lot more regulations, and that's because NASA has had two space shuttles blow up. I mean, you know, I don't mean to be callous, but when stuff like that happens, safety regulations go up a huge amount. And so stuff that they did back in the Apollo day, they would not be able to do today because of safety regulations. They wouldn't be able to get away with it. It would just cost a heck of a lot more money to put in all those extra safety regulations that NASA and the government would require. But the point is that all because we would do something one way today, like go to the moon powered by a supercomputer maybe, doesn't mean that we needed that to do it 50 years ago. And, you know, while I don't have the technical expertise to go through every single system that they used and explain why it was valid, I think that that general argument is enough that you shouldn't take what Bart says with full weight. I mean, you have to, the whole point of what I do is not to debunk stuff, except in a few cases, but it's more to present the whole story and the scientific side and to say, okay, this is why I don't believe that we didn't go to the moon. This is why I don't believe his evidence. And, you know, he said that the Russians had 5 times more time in space than we did. And okay, well, so what? It's about quality, not quantity. It's about a goal. Like, you could say, okay, I have 10 times more diving experience than you, but all I did was dive into a swimming pool. I mean, you've actually, say, deep sea dived, and therefore you are going to be much better at your goal of reaching the Marianas Trench than I'm going to be. And so it's, you know, you present stuff one side and you get a conspiracy theory, you see more sides and you start to go, well, maybe I shouldn't take the conspiracy theory for all that people say it is.
Well, you present a good case for that, in that when Columbus or any of the explorers, I'm just using Columbus, he comes to mind first, but anybody that was in some kind of oak plank ship, boat, right, with sails on it, is just going out, they don't know what's on the other side of that horizon, and they're taking off. Why, you know, they would have been better off if, you know, with later technology and an engine on board. Well, you know what? They did it when they did it because curiosity is what killed the cat. They're going to go and do it, and they're going to go and discover things. And that's what happened with Apollo. You know, of course, we have more technology today, and we've got better computers, and we've got everything else that we have today. But you know what? At that time in space, right then, they had enough to get man off of the planet and shoot in the direction of the moon, and damn it, we're going to go check it out. If they die, they die, but it's the risk, and we're going to go explore. I get that. I really do. I understand. But I just don't think, in my heart of hearts, in my gut feeling, knowing now, it's the radiation, and it's the fact of those spacesuits and the temperature and the batteries and the cooling systems And I find it hard to believe that, you know, they had to tumble through space in the command module to keep one side cool and one side hot, and they did that because they couldn't use air conditioning. I mean, I don't know. It just, to me, it just seems like a whole random series of luck that came out on the right side of luck, and that they returned here safe. I don't know. It's just my gut feeling. Now, knowing what I know now, I just, man, but... You know, maybe we did do it. Maybe we did. I don't know. I like I said, I'm on both sides of the fence with it. And don't you think radiation, I remember you pointing out that the Van Allen belt isn't, and I'm not here to debate whether we went to the moon or not. It's not my point. But you did make, you made some statements about the radiation in the Van Allen belt isn't as extreme as not only Bart, but the other conspiracy theorists are out there pointing. So how do you say...
The radiation of the Van Allen belt is, you know, a lot of people do point to it as a limiting factor. The problem is that the radiation of the Van Allen belt that people would want you to shield from, you know, with this 6 foot of lead shielding is a thing that's often stated. That's not the good way to do it because of the type of radiation that is in the Van Allen belts. 6 foot of lead shielding would actually be the worst way to shield yourself from that radiation because it would produce secondary radiation that's even more dangerous. the main stuff that's in the Van Allen belts are protons and electrons. I mean, you can shield yourself from protons fairly easily, thin shielding, electrons. It's similar. Like, I'm sort of winging this off the seat of my pants because I wasn't as prepared for the radiation stuff.
That's okay.
I can say that I have blogged extensively about it, and I do have a podcast episode out about the radiation stuff as well. So I would say, even though my argument just in the last minute or so has sounded pretty vague and isn't going to convince anyone, I will say, go to the blog, go to the podcast, and I do talk about the radiation claim. And then do your own research. And that's one thing that I try to say a lot as well, is do your own research into this stuff. Don't take my word for it. Definitely don't take the conspiracy word for it. But look at what radiation is in the Van Allen belts, and look at how you would shield from that apart from going to Apollo hoax sites, and see what happens, and make up your own mind based on that information.
Well, like I said, I'm not here to debate it, but I could debate it all night. I want, and this is the truth. This is straight. This is being as straight as I can be. I'm a proud American, and I'm proud of our achievements. I saw, you know, the moon landing live. I never felt warmer in my life. I'm just saying, today, as an adult, looking back, looking at the technology that we have today and what we were dealing with in 1960, 1965, 1966 is nothing compared to today. And I'm like in the middle. I'm playing both sides of the fence, and I just want all the knowledge that I can get on it. I really, really do. I want to learn and learn and learn so I can make more of an educated decision on it. Right now, I find it just hard to believe that you can, you know, go out there for 3 days exposed to the sun like that with no protection. You know, everything was, you know, thin-skinned aluminum, and you're wearing just a normal clothes for a spacesuit, and it's just crazy to me. That's all. That's it. Okay.
Well, the suits are more than just, you know, normal fabric. I mean, there's a lot more to them, a lot more insulation. And the insulation was needed. You mentioned the temperature stuff. I mean, the thing about...
Well, that spacesuit isn't going to protect you from an X-ray, okay? You're going to go... And
but
you're
there wasn't that much. If there had no, been no, solar no, what flare, the astronauts probably would have been dead. But there wasn't.
And what if there would have been some catastrophic solar activity? Or when they were standing on the face of the moon, that's the other thing, those extreme swings in temperature. And you know what it's like going out on a cold winter day and you're all layered up, or on a hot day when you're taking clothes off. And they're out there to the real extremes. I don't know what it would.
I mean, that's
400 degree swing. You know, I don't know. I'm just saying, it just seems a little crazy for me now as an adult. It's like, you know, when you're told a story when you're a kid by your dad, when you believe everything, and then you grow up and you just realize, oh, okay, all right, now I know the real world. Well, that's kind of how I feel about it now. That's all. And
well, one thing about the conspiracy stuff though is you have to think. If you're examining it from an outside opinion as opposed to coming at it from the conspiracy point, you have to realize that NASA isn't necessarily really stupid. In fact, the conspiracists will have you believe that they're incredibly brilliant to be able to pull this off, and yet also incredibly stupid to have you leave these little breadcrumbs that they can pick up on. But with the temperature stuff, they weren't out there during the heat of the full sun. Like, it wasn't an... It was basically like dawn or dusk on the moon for most of the missions. They weren't out there when it was dark, when it was nighttime. They weren't out there generally in the full sun either. And while, yeah, it seems like, you know, when you go outside, or, you know, I baked potatoes this evening for dinner, or as part of dinner. I had some protein with it. But I baked potatoes, and I opened the oven, and I had it at 450 degrees Fahrenheit. I mean, that's about as hot as it gets sometimes during the peak of the day on the moon. But that doesn't mean that that's what the astronauts would have felt. And that's what this is why your experience on Earth does not prepare you for what to expect on the moon. And that's something that you have to take to heart. So the only way to transfer heat on the moon is pretty much by conduction. So the astronauts' boots physically touching the lunar surface, that's the only way they're really going to get much heat transfer. Yeah, you're going to get sunlight hitting you, but that radiation, and it's called radiation, which sounds scary, but you know, it's a, you stand outside, you look up to the sun, you spread out your arms, and you feel warm. That's the radiative energy. The fastest way to actually transfer heat is convection, so moving stuff around, like water boiling. But conduction is really the fastest way that the astronauts had. And as long as their boots were really, really well insulated, which they were, then they were pretty well insulated from getting heated up. And again, not only that, but because most of the EVAs, extravehicular activity, I think, happened during, you know, not when the sun was straight overhead, not when it had, the lunar surface had been exposed to the sunlight for a full week, but more during the dawn hours, the lunar regolith, the soil that they were walking on, hadn't had that time to heat up to that temperature. And also, I mean, it's so fragmented that it's not a very good conductor of heat itself. And it doesn't, first off, it's going to take a long time for it to warm up, and then it's going to take a long time for it to transfer that heat to the astronauts' boots. So, I mean, yeah, you gave the example of going outside on a winter day here on Earth or a summer day and you get blasted by this heat. There's nothing to blast them. Like, there is no air on the moon to hit them with all that heat or to take away the heat from them if it's really cold.
All really good points. I'm sitting here listening and thinking, okay, all right, I'll back off. It all comes down to technology. It really does. Now, based on a lot of this conversation that we're having right now, what is it? What makes a hoaxer? You know, I mean it in more of a broad term. What is in their mindset that they can just base their life on something that they know isn't true? You know, what let's get into that aspect of it. Why? Because you're dealing with it. It's kind of like your job in your podcast. This show's a little bit different in that I go in every different direction all day long, and it's fun. But for you, you're inside these guys' head sometimes. Or all the time. What is it that drives these guys? They can't be making a whole lot of money from it. Is it fame? What drives them? And what were they like, do you think, as kids? You know, I mean,
I'm going to give that answer with a short non-answer. I don't really know. I'm not a psychologist. I like to say I played one in college where I was one class short of a psych minor, but I really don't know. I mean, some people just truly, honestly believe it. I don't know if Bart Cybrill is one of those people. He sounds like he is. I have no reason to doubt it. He might really, truly believe it. And
Bart's a little bit different. And no, he's a lot different. He actually doesn't fall into that category in that he's based his stuff on research based on some film that he got. So he was intrigued and went into a direction. But when you deal with these other mindsets out there where they are, it's not based on anything. It's only based on what their eyes are telling them. And then they convince somebody else. You did a really good analogy the other day. I was listening to one of your old podcasts, and today I was talking to somebody on the phone about tonight's show, and the very same analogy was brought up, and they know nothing about you, but it's the simple one. You look up into clouds in the sky and you see what you see. And I said today, well, I see Washington crossing the Delaware. That's what I see in the clouds, but that doesn't mean it's Washington crossing the Delaware. It's really that simple. But so they're basing it on that. Bart, on the other hand, is basing his stuff just on facts, and he's trying to uncover facts on a real event. Okay, everything else is fabricated from, and without naming names and getting off into that tangent. But why would somebody continue to when nothing has come to fruition, not one thing from anybody that we could name here now. We keep saying that, naming names, but
that's fine.
Nothing has come to fruition. Not one thing where they have a bullet in their gun where they can go, ah, see, I told you it's real. Well, no, it's all based on nothing. And what would drive them to do that, to constantly convince, and look at Sitchin is a really good example of that, actually, where he was convincing everybody for years. I don't know how many millions of books have been sold and how many minds have been sold on something that was based on nothing and continued to base on nothing because there was no facts there. So, you know, what drove him? Was it fame? Was it money? I just don't get it. I truly don't understand that mindset.
Well, I think, so let me present a scenario to you that I think is plausible for at least some people, possibly Sitchin included, is you see something that doesn't make sense to you in the context of everything else that you know and everything else that you've heard. And so you do a little bit of investigation. And you're not necessarily an expert in this field. You don't have the background that people who have studied it their entire lives do. You're sort of the armchair amateur archaeologist kind of thing. And you look into this and you already sort of are prone to, well, that's the official story. Let's see what this shows. And you go into it and you look at it and you're like, wow, this is completely different from what people say. And they can't seem to explain it, or they ignore exactly what I'm trying to talk about. And the people ignoring you who are in the position of authority, it's kind of like, well, they just don't want it to get out. They actually know about it. They just don't want it to get out. And so you keep on doing your investigation, and now you're invested in it. And you start to develop this, what I'll call a mythology around these ideas. And you have this mythology, maybe you write a book about it, and hey, for Sitchin, it took off. Many people have debunked him over the years. Like, they have gone into each and every bit of evidence that he presents and independently shown this is baloney. It's not valid. You're mistranslating this stuff. It doesn't work out scientifically. It doesn't work out technologically. It doesn't work out archaeologically. And yet, let's say they might sort of convince you, but now you're invested in it. And it is incredibly difficult to say that you're wrong, especially when you've sold millions of books and to millions of people, assuming, you know, it's not the same person buying a million copies.
Right.
And so you are now invested in it, and it's going to be very hard to go back. Meanwhile, other people who you might have convinced pick up the flag, so to speak. And they find other anomalies that they don't understand because they don't have the expertise in the field either to really have the context of understanding what's going on. Like, you know, the temperature claim with the moon. I mean, to me, that is just, it doesn't make any sense because this is how you transfer. It's basic physics. We know how this works. And so they'd be safe kind of situation. But there are so many, to return to the Apollo moon hoax, there are so many other claims that are made. I mean, there's the technology that you mentioned. There's the no stars claim. There's all of these other things. And in order to, you know, go through and, I'll use the term, debunk every single one of them, you have to be an expert in, for the moon hoax, photography, geology, physics, radiation, heat transfer, history, mechanics, and all sorts of other fields, including history and technology, in order to explain those observations. And if I'm talking with someone who, for lack of a better word, believes in the Apollo moon hoax stuff, and my explanation made for every single claim they raised, say, made complete and total sense, and they no longer believe it. But there's that one thing that I didn't explain very well. And to give the example, the radiation stuff, I kind of sucked at that explanation on the spur of the moment. Well, then you still have that anomaly, and that limiting radiation means we definitely didn't go to the moon. But my point, and sort of where I'm coming from, is, okay, you have put forward 50 different claims I've successfully shown that every single one of them, except for one, is perfectly wrong. Maybe you should go and do the research on that last claim and see if maybe it's also wrong as well. Meanwhile, again, it's really hard to do that just because hoaxes are built, or not necessarily hoaxes, but conspiracy theories that sometimes involve hoaxes are just built around so many disparate pieces of information. All I have to do to start a hoax or a conspiracy is to say, this thing doesn't make sense to me, and boom, there it is. It takes 5 seconds. Meanwhile, in order to debunk it, you spend tens of thousands of words and hours of research trying to figure out what's really going on. And so I think that's why it's so easy for the conspiracy theories to propagate, whereas it's so much more difficult to actually go through and, again, for lack of a better word, debunk them.
When, okay, and I feel like we're debating the moon hoax, but let's continue.
it's a good example.
It's a great example. But when we take something like the moon, and which is something that anybody, you, myself, my next door neighbor, we can go spend a couple hundred dollars on a very amateur telescope and pop it up in the backyard and stare at it all day long. Very, very convincingly see the moon up close and personal. You don't have to be an astronomer to do that. But when you start to go and make extraordinary claims about anomalies on the moon and, you know, two mile tall objects that are, you know, not natural, and you just go and you start making these claims when you know, and I want to get back to Sitchin in a second. It's kind of the same subject. When you know, it can be researched. You know this. It's one thing to make a claim about being abducted by aliens, and which could have happened or not. But there's nothing to research there. You're just making a claim. You're making a statement. You can't go and research that. It's either true or it's not. But if you're making claims about objects on the face of Mars, or you're making claims about something on the moon, you'd better be right, because there's plenty of ways to investigate that. And I don't understand what motivates somebody to make those extraordinary claims when it's so easy for, it's not even debunking, Stuart. You're not debunking anything when you're doing that. You're just saying, hey, look, I don't see what you see. What are you talking about? It doesn't exist. But yet people believe it. By the millions. And I don't understand. When you go back, well, okay, so what do you think about that? Why what would motivate somebody when it's so easy to debunk is not the word. Disprove? You know, if you're
disprove, show is wrong, doesn't exist in the first place. I don't know.
You wouldn't use the word debunk in the court of law, but there's a word there that I'm not grabbing onto right now. But
yeah, I mean, I don't like the term debunk because it makes it seem so very, very negative, and skeptics have this negative connotation these days that I don't like. But it's a word that's useful because everybody knows what it means. So with the qualifier that by when I say debunking, I don't mean it in a negative way.
Exactly. Exactly.
We can use debunking.
Okay.
In some cases that I've seen, they just make it because it's easy and they've already convinced a bunch of people. And if the people that they've convinced, you know, most of the people they've convinced just don't think about it and just believe everything they already say, then you can put something out there that is so easy to show is wrong, but they do it anyway because their followers, you know, it's just more food for them. It's like, oh yeah, totally, yeah, I believe it. And you've now fed them. Even if you've fed them disgusting, moldy, rotten lettuce that I actually just threw out today, you've still fed them something to get them through to the next thing that you can show them that maybe is a little bit harder to show is completely crazy. I have a few people in mind, but yeah, to not name names, you know, that's just something that I've seen with a few people.
Now, this is, and just so you can understand how the mind of Jimmy Church works, as far as an object on the moon goes or an object on the Mars, on the surface of Mars, nobody wants that to be real or true more than myself. I go back to Kubrick in 2001. And what that movie is based on is one of the coolest things ever. How cool would it be if there was an actual monolith on the moon that we found? Wouldn't that be just the turning point of all mankind? Wouldn't that be an amazing thing? Yeah, exactly. So nobody wants it. Nobody.
I totally agree with you. I mean, I love the Stargate series, and you know, maybe I like some of the actors or actresses more than I like the series, but you know, I loved the idea
of
that existing.
Exactly.
The problem is when people bring that into real life and say, no, this is actually real and going on, that it's like, whoa.
Well, and you know, so I want that to be real. It's not like I'm some negative, boring, just closed-minded, you know, no. That's not why I'm, you know, and that's not my point. I really want that stuff to be true. I want it to be real.
I'd love for there to be face on Mars, and pyramids on Mars, all that stuff.
Which goes back to Göbekli Tepe. And I don't know if you're familiar with Göbekli Tepe. It doesn't matter. But for everybody, all of the Orthodox archaeologists that are out there, you know, which is everyone, the Giza pyramids was it. It was like that. That's where civilization started. Sumeria, that part of the world, the wheel, you know, writing, logs for farming and all of that stuff. Math. It all started then. And the numbers that are thrown around are always, you know, 2500 BC, 3000 BC, 3500 BC. Before that, man was an idiot. And 5000 BC, man was, you know, walking around with a club. There were woolly mammoths still on the earth, whatever their excuse for things were. But then, for some reason, the pyramids just happened. And intelligence just happened. And then all of a sudden, and this is the way that we believed everything up until 1995. And miracles do happen, Stuart. And that miracle, for all of us out there, because I have a big question mark about civilization between 12,000 BC and 5,000 BC. That's 7,000 years of a blank spot in history. You have the Ice Age, and then you have the pyramids. Do you understand what I'm saying? Okay?
Yes.
Now, but Göbekli Tepe happened in 1995, and Göbekli Tepe is real. And what Göbekli Tepe said to everybody, it's been carbon dated many times and officially dated now to 12,000 BC and potentially 14,000, going right up and into the Ice Age, but that man was civilized, man was intelligent, man had farming, man had a government, man had civilization, man had structure, man had a city that long ago. And Göbekli Tepe is real. So it allows all of us to go up to those Orthodox archaeologists and go, so you guys are wrong. And now how do you explain this? And what went on between Göbekli Tepe and here? And what else is buried? It kind of takes me back to what we were talking about with Kubrick and the monolith on the moon, you know, how it was uncovered. Well, suddenly Göbekli Tepe was deliberately buried. You know about this. And it was deliberately buried for some unknown reason. And now we've uncovered it. And how much more, how many more Göbekli Tepes of the world are out there? We don't know. But so it just starts to point to certain things where you just don't know. Miracles can happen. You can't base everything on hard, you know, absolute no, which is what the Egyptologist and the... I keep saying Orthodoxy archaeology, but that's really the truth. Where now these guys have to answer for everybody, and that takes me back to anomalies on the moon. You never know; there could something pop up there someday. There could be something on Mars, just like Göbekli Tepe popped up. We didn't know that Göbekli Tepe was even there, and suddenly now we have to answer for that and fix things. But it's, again, nobody wants anything up there on the moon more than me. And that's the truth. I really hope we, uncover something up there. That would be amazing. But until then, don't lie about it. And don't, you know, and don't force stuff down that isn't based on fact. It's just not right. Now, listen, really quick. I want everybody to do the normal thing. I like your last tweet. That's pretty funny. Go to jimmychurchradio.com. The audience knows the drill. Scroll down, and we've got tonight's gallery for Stuart up. And fascinating stuff, by the way, Stuart, and I'm glad you selected what you selected.
I thought it might pique your interest.
Well, you know, pareidolia, man. Uh-huh. Because, okay, now I'm sure you've got your computer open and you're looking at, but I want to go straight to the face on Mars, picture number 4 in the top row. Mm-hmm. Okay, so everybody go, this is the famous one. Now, and I want to, I've got it open. I'm going to give everybody a little bit of time to go and open this up. And
well, while they're doing that, could I just quickly follow up on what you were saying?
Yes.
So I want to say that I think that most scientists got into science because we want to know what's going on. And we want to figure it out. We want to do that investigation. I mean, I've heard so many times on, you know, various paranormal radio shows, you know, they don't need to be named, but probably most people know what they are. I've heard so many people say, oh, those scientists, they just uphold the orthodoxy in their ivory towers, the status quo, the Brookings report, you know, all this stuff. And I'm just like, you are very obviously not a scientist, because the entire point of doing science is to investigate this stuff with an open mind and try to figure out what's really going on. Usually, yeah, we uphold the status quo. The reason it's the status quo, the reason why there's something called the scientific consensus, is because so many lines of evidence have said that's what's really going on. And sometimes there are game changers. And you know, we all really want to be the person who makes that game changer name. I mean, for example, Albert Einstein is a household name. And you know, if I said Albert Einstein, I can probably safely say that every single one listening to your radio program tonight or in the archives knows who that person is. But if I said somebody else's name that I don't even remember, which is part of my point, they wouldn't recognize it. And that's because all he did was verify that Einstein's predictions from general relativity hold up for the, you know, thousandth time that it was tested. And so what? I mean, you know, that's great for him, great for his career. You know, that's, I'm not trying to minimize that. You know, confirming other people's observations is one of the other primary things about science. But we all want to be, you know, the next household name. And you do that by making these paradigm-changing discoveries. The problem and the difference is that we have a higher threshold of evidence than most people who will tell you that, for example, what we're about to talk about, that the face on Mars is real. We have a higher threshold of evidence for believing that.
Right. No, that's a really good point. And since that famous equation, well, all of those theories of relativity that he had worked on and not finished and finished, we haven't had anything really too groundbreaking since then. It's kind of amazing. And if you stop and think about it, everything that Hawkins has done, and I'm not diminishing Kaku and all of the other, like you said, household names that are out there, but those guys are all, string theory is okay. All right. I get that. I understand. Well, I sort of understand it, but I understand where they are going with that, but it's hasn't been proven. And there isn't anything since, when did E equal MC square hit the front page?
Within the first 15 years of the 1900s, I don't know the exact year.
Yeah, exactly. And what's the groundbreaking thing since then? Possibly black holes? Possibly?
Well, black holes were a prediction of relativity, though.
Yeah, that's right.
So and, you know, quantum mechanics was sort of concurrent with relativity, but it was maybe a decade-ish later,
right?
As it was really getting formulated. So, you know, you could say maybe quantum mechanics, you know, physics-wise, but you know, physics-wise.
But what I'm not say, hold on, yeah. I'm going to stop you. You can't say anything. You could say maybe this, maybe that, But we're still stuck, and we still base everything on E equals MC squared. Fantastic, but we haven't had that next big breakthrough. Now listen, really quick, but before we get to the Face on Mars, everybody get over to jimmychurchradio.com, get down to the gallery, open up the Face on Mars. Last picture on the right in the top row. Before we move on, I want to touch on this subject briefly. But this is an email that just came in from Australia a couple of minutes ago. This is from JC. He says Western Australia. He says, "Hi, Jimmy. The story goes, we are advancing fast with technology after an alien spacecraft crashed, so why not use that technology to go to the moon? And why fiber optics and all of the other inventions known to man give credit to back engineering and alien technology that boosted mankind, and yet the moon landing has never been mentioned with the possibility of back engineering alien tech at all. Maybe that's how they pass through the radiation belt." And then he says, you know, but what do I know? Regards, JC. Thank you, JC, for the email. And the reason why I wanted to read that to you is the subject of ET. Do you think that we have ever been visited by an intelligent off-world species? Ever.
With my agnostic answer is, I don't know. I don't think that the evidence people have presented is good enough to tip me over that threshold. I don't necessarily see why not, but I also don't necessarily see why yes. So
okay.
That's my agnostic, wishy-washy, nobody's going to like me answer.
No. Okay. Maybe I asked the question the wrong way. No, I did, but... See, you think so analytical, man. You're a black and white guy, and I love you for that.
That's what my high school English teachers hated me for. I could never get an A in their classes.
Now, the question was, do you think? That's all. The Earth is, what, 3.5-4 billion years old? So that's a big span of time. So my question is, do you think we have been visited one time ever? That's all. Not based on science fact or what evidence has been there. There's no evidence from 200,000 years ago if somebody could have done a drive-by. That's my question. Do you think there's a lot of intelligence out there? Anybody did a drive-by here on planet Earth ever?
No, I understood your question. My answer is the same. I mean,
okay.
It's...
Okay, all right.
It's possible. I just, you know, it's kind of one of those... You know, what if questions, sure, it's fun to think about. I don't see any reason why not. But I don't see necessarily any reason to say yes. I mean,
Fair enough. Yeah. Fair enough.
It would be interesting if yes. It would be interesting if no. I mean, it's sort of that Fermi paradox.
You turned it into a paradox. You
Sorry.
Didn't have to. Now
I told you weren't going to like the answer.
Now, do you think we are alone?
I lean more towards the answer I gave with a leaning more towards probably not, because the universe is so vast and because there's so much of it that we are still trying to discover and figure out. The more stuff comes out of, you know, the Kepler probe, for example, with the more planets that are out there, to me, it seems likely that there are other, you know, at least other life out there, whether it's reached an advanced stage or not, and that's more debatable. But I would say, you know, in such a large universe, you know, even in such a large galaxy with as many planets as our galaxy has, it is probably yes. But again, it's, you know, from a scientific standpoint, it's an almost impossible question to answer. And anyone from NASA's Astrobiology Institute listening to me right now is going to absolutely hate me for saying that. But, you know.
Well, I heard you say something the other day, it doesn't matter, on one of your podcasts. But you said this one thing that I wish I would have said it, kind of things, where you said, I believe, correct me if I'm wrong, because this is just memory. You can't prove science. You can only prove math. Isn't it? Is that correct?
Yeah, there are only proofs in math. There's no proofs in any other field. In science, it's just getting iteratively closer to a model that explains our observations.
So based on that statement, I think that you're being a little wishy-washy then. because if you can't prove it, then, you know, life, we're not talking about math. We're talking about life. and intelligent life. I pulled this up a few weeks ago. I saw it. I was thinking about this, and so I just went and pulled this number up. But this is what is fascinating to me, and then you can change your answer if you want. But I know what you've got your PhD in. I realize your research. I understand. But based on that, I know you know these numbers to heart. But there are 300 billion stars in the Milky Way. Okay? And our galaxy is one of at least 100 billion in the universe. And so when you just base that, if you can get your mind around that crazy of a number, and I have no idea how many zeros we're dealing with, you do, but there has to be a lot, not one, but there has to be a lot of intelligence out there. There has to be. And even if it was some crazy small number, like 100,000 years more advanced than us, because based on this and the age of the universe, what's 100,000 years? That's a blip. So if we are reaching out the way we are now in our little primitive, you know, Neanderthal existence on this earth, we are now reaching out. Pioneer 11 is now outside of our solar system. You know, so we're doing our best to reach out. You know that they're doing the exact same thing that we are. And it's just preposterous to think for somebody to tell me that we haven't been visited. It just comes from ignorance. I really believe that. You just can't say no, because they have to be looking back the same way that we are looking out, and we are easily discoverable. You know, we actually have life here. You know, we're out looking at planets that don't have life, and we're we have to, okay, no. Oh, possibly, yeah, possible, no. You know, but coming back and looking at us, we're like a Christmas tree, just lit up, you know, and 100 years ago, before electricity, we still had lights in the street and gas lamps. Our cities were still lit up at night. Before that, campfires, and you know what I mean? There's life on this planet that you can see. You can see it when you drive by. So I just find it, no, it's preposterous to think that we haven't been visited. There's tons of life out there just based on those numbers.
Okay.
That's it. That's my view. Do I have any proof of anything? No, I'm not looking for proof. I don't need proof. You know, when I look at those numbers, I just find it crazy to think that somebody hasn't done a drive-by in the last 3 billion years. I just find it crazy. No, there's no way.
You know, as a human, and you know, as someone who, you know, occasionally thinks philosophically, I want to say absolutely yes, that there's intelligent life out there. You know, the universe is simply too vast for there not to be. But you know, then the higher brain function, you know, the analytical part kicks in. I don't want to say higher because that makes me sound arrogant. The analytical part of me kicks in and is like, well, but you have no idea how hard it is for life to form. You have no idea how hard it is for advanced life to survive. And so you really, you know, to me, I don't think that we have the knowledge to really figure out what the likelihood of life out there or other life out there being, what the probability actually is. But, you know, as you said, sort of almost a gut feeling or desire, yeah, like I'd love for there to be other life out there. And, you know, I'll say right now, just as I said about science, I would love to be the person to discover it.
And, absolutely.
I mean, that's what people don't realize is, you know, oh, well, NASA's found life on Mars and they're covering it up. It's like, are you insane? If NASA found evidence, good evidence, solid evidence of life on Mars, they would publicize it as much as they could, because that would mean they would actually get funding. It's just like, you know,
yes.
At this stage, follow the money. I mean, you know, NASA's funding is in the toilet right now. And it's just like the people who say that they're just covering it up, you know, it's the same thing. Not to stray too far, but you know, it's the same thing of drug companies covering up the cure for cancer. It's like their advertising would be written for the next century if a drug company found a quote-unquote cure for cancer. The idea of them covering it up is just, to me, it doesn't make any kind of sense. And for fear of straying way too far, I'll stop there.
Okay. Let's go back to Mars.
Okay.
And
a little closer to home. Well, a little farther from home.
A little farther from home. It was fascinating with the blood moon, how close Mars was to that. To be able to sit there and look, you didn't have to move your head. You didn't even have to move your eyes. They were right next to each other, and they were both the same shade of red, too. It was kind of trippy. That was a moment in time, and I'm really looking forward to the next three. I didn't think it was going to be that cool. I didn't think it was going to be that great. I just thought it was going to be a letdown. I just didn't know what degree of letdown. But it always is a letdown. That wasn't. That was pretty freaking amazing. Okay, so now we're looking at Cydonia, and my first comments about this when, and I'm going to set this up for everybody very, very, very briefly. When Hoagland broke the news of this back in the mid-90s, and the exact date doesn't matter, but at that time, he was really lucky because there was a few seminal events that were happening at the same time. Number one, the internet. Okay? That was a big deal. So you had a lot of curious people out there discovering things on the web and learning. You know, it's not like going to the library. You're tapping on a keyboard, any fascinating subject that you've ever had any question of ever in the history of your life, and boom, now you apparently could find it on the internet. So
especially
he,
Star Trek.
Yeah, totally. Exactly. So he had that element going for him. That combined with Art Bell, thank you, Art, for his show at that time was booming. There was a lot of things that were causing that boom. Bob Lazar and Area 51 and the subject of UFOs. So Hoagland had that going for him too. It was like the perfect little synchronicity thing where that convergence was all happening at the same time where he was able to drop this bomb on everybody, including myself. So when I first saw this picture that we're looking at here, when we first saw this and he's mapping it out, the 19.5 degrees. By the way, I can't let you get away tonight without that discussion. And we've got to touch upon that. And longitude and latitude and how it's measured on Mars. I want to get to that too as well. I'm still a little confused on it. But so now, which takes us to this picture. And so when he first whipped this out and I looked at it and I'm listening to him, I was kind of seeing it, okay? I wasn't overtaken by pareidolia completely, but I wanted to believe. Now, let's discuss this picture. Let's take this down here. When was this taken, and what craft took this picture? What?
Well, this was United States, NASA's Viking Orbiter 1.
Oh, it was Viking 1, okay.
Yeah. Back in the 1970s, and I know I'm going to mess it up, so I'm just going to say it was 1976. I'm not entirely sure of day, month, etc. I could look it up if you wanted.
No, it's okay. No. So, and in this picture, you have the city, you have the pyramids, you have, isn't that, there's a five-sided pyramid here too. That's right, down here at the bottom.
And July 25th.
You cracked me up. You know, one of the things when I was bringing you on the show, I don't know if you've noticed this, but on your podcast, one of the brilliant things that you do, everybody has crutches, but you have a crutch of perfect English. Okay? And the mispronunciation, misuse of words. And I love it when I hear you correct yourself. You are so...
Yeah, sometimes it's just easier to say, scratch that, as opposed to going back and erasing the audio and re-recording it.
Oh, you're just so funny. I thought, now, Stuart's going to come on my show, and it's going to be like my 12th grade English teacher, Mrs. Thomas, rapping me on my knuckles every 5 minutes, correcting my speech. Okay, so now let's get back to this. So when Hoagland whipped this out on everybody and started talking about the city and everything, I didn't buy into it. I didn't have that pareidolia. I'm pronouncing that correct, right?
Pareidolia?
Pareidolia, I'm sorry. I wasn't overtaken by pareidolia with this picture. Other ones, okay, a little more extreme. But this, I didn't see it. But the famous face on Mars, the picture needs to be rotated if you want to see it the way that it was put in all of the newspapers. And that was the mistake, I think, that NASA made. Because when they announced that, you know, I remember seeing it in the newspapers, you know, a face on Mars. Well, they shouldn't have done that. Because that allowed the power of suggestion to take everybody mm-hmm. over. So now this picture was taken. I'm sorry. We're displaying it the way that Viking 1 took the picture.
Right.
Correct? So to see it the way that Hoagland has presented it, we have to actually rotate it. Am I correct? Yeah.
Roughly 135 degrees clockwise.
You crack me up.
Very, very well. I'm just glancing at it right now, and it's like it's at about a 45 degree angle. So,
right,
you know, rotate it 90 degrees and then half of 90 degrees again. Yeah,
okay,
clockwise.
And then you can see the face on Mars. Now, why do you think? Okay, so actually, now, okay, I keep interrupting you. Take us through the picture, and what is it that? And I know it was easy to shoot down, but what is it that you think he was trying to have people see? I don't see it here. The only thing that is there is the face on Mars. Is there the landscape, the ground cover, and the irregularities that are there? Is that what is easy for us to convert in our own mind's eye into a city? You know, I mean, were you ever... You know, convinced of that? No. That's the wrong word. Did you ever see what he was suggesting? That's correct.
I don't see a city. I mean, yeah, the quote unquote face on Mars does look like a face. And then I think he was pointing to a lot of other things as pyramids. And so I don't have. I never read his. I think 900 page book. One thing I'll say about Richard is that he is very wordy. He has a very long book, The Monuments of Mars, City on the Edge of Forever or something, an allusion to Star Trek, the original series. And I want to say a lot of what he pointed to was the face, and then what he said were pyramids in this image. And if you squint your eyes and look at a very low-resolution version of this image with this type of light, with this type of photographic material, yeah, you could say that these objects elsewhere in the image kind of look like pyramids. And I think that that's what he was trying to do, is that he initially had those two parts to it, and then he started to look at geometry. And he's very prone to say, I think that he said it comes from Arthur C. Clarke, that I'm going to just paraphrase that, intelligence reveals itself through geometry, that if you see like a regular grid layout, then that's most likely done by intelligent beings. I would disagree on what that means, because we see lots of types of geometry that's completely natural. For example, the Grand Canyon displays beautiful fractal geometry, but that was not intelligently made. So... He had the face, he had the pyramids, and then he started to draw lines. And he said, okay, well, this angle between these two walls of what I'm going to call a pyramid is 120 degrees, or is 45 degrees, or is 90 degrees. Basically, looking for these magic numbers that you typically use in architecture, because that's normal geometry, like on a five-sided shape, a five-sided regular shape, a pentagram, each vertex is an angle of 120 degrees. On a three-sided perfect triangle, you have an equilateral triangle, you have 60 degrees. On a square, you have 90, you know, that kind of thing. So he found a few of those, and then he also started to draw lines with distances between things, and started taking ratios, and started doing trigonometry, like taking the cosine or sine or tangent of these. And some of them came up close to various magic universal numbers in mathematics, like E, which is 2.71, or etc. That you use that with compound interest, for example, or pi, which is I always have to say cherry equal pi delicious. So pi is the ratio of the circumference to the diameter of a circle. So he came up with a few of these lines had ratios of pi once you did other things to them. And
well, really, this was one of the things that so fascinated me with Hoagland's original research. When you take a low resolution picture like this and you're going to start drawing lines with a triangle or a straight edge, a ruler, and you're starting to draw lines on this and coming to these dramatic conclusions. But if you move, there's nothing to pinpoint your fixed points of degree on this picture. One little width of a pencil lead changes all the numbers completely.
Exactly.
And so with this type of, it's not high resolution, you know, it looks high resolution to us because it's in focus, but it's not a high resolution picture. So you don't know if the point of the supposed pyramid is the apex of that pyramid. You have no idea. You could be off by literally hundreds of meters, if not kilometers. Okay, do you understand what I'm saying? And you're going to base your lines of degree and your mathematics. If one of those is off by a little bit, everything's off, let alone every single angle that you're drawing. And it looks technical. It looks impressive. When you see everything drawn out, you're like, wow, okay. All right, I get it. This makes sense. But it's based on a low resolution photograph where a pixel, like, for example, in this picture right here, in this Viking 1 shot of Sidonia, how big is one pixel?
Oh, let's see. One pixel is something like roughly 50 meters on a side.
15 meters.
No, 55-0. So about 55. 150 feet.
Okay, 150 feet. Now, Richard, what are you doing? You know, how can you base anything on anything when there's no accuracy involved?
Well, so I wouldn't go that far. You know,
I do go that far. Stuart, you can't.
Well, you're the host.
Well, my point is, if you're going to draw, if you're going to make something a five-sided pyramid in this photograph, where's your five sides? His other two or three sides in that pyramid are based on shadow. So that's just a basic thing. You cannot. You just can't. It's impossible. You can't get he made this fantastic statement. We should have had the audio brought up, where he talked about how the face on Mars and the downtown square and the five sided pyramid are 19.5 degrees. You know, wait a minute. Based on what? The Viking is cruising across the face of Mars. You don't know what degree based on perpendicular on the equator. You know, what are you basing this 19.5 degrees on? You don't know what this picture represents. You have no idea what area. Do you understand what I'm saying? And I just don't get that. I don't understand what he was basing this on when I thought it was 50 meters. I didn't know it was 55 or 150 feet. That's incredible to me. Incredible.
Yeah. Well, 50 meters is 150 feet.
Yeah. 150 feet. Yeah. So,
Well, so I wouldn't quite go that far just because, you know, you can get a lot of science from low resolution images. And we have much worse resolution images for a lot of objects in the solar system, and we've gotten a lot of good science from it. But the issue is, if I can sort of twist a little bit of what you said, just because, again, I don't want to seem as though I'm attacking Richard, but it's more to what accuracy are you claiming based upon the data? And in this case, I agree with you that it's just the level of accuracy claimed when analyzing these images to get these exact ratios. And I'm looking at one of his images now, and he's claiming that one of these is the equivalent of like e over pi, and then another one is pi over e, and then another one is the square root of 5 over e. And it's just like, it's exactly what you said. If you shift it by a pixel, you're going to get a different result in this type of analysis. And so while these low resolution, relative to what we have of Mars now, while these low resolution images are still useful to get a lot of stuff out of it, you just have to be incredibly aware of what their limitations are. And I think that one of the ways that Richard, or one of the reasons why a lot of us would classify Richard as a pseudoscientist, is because he goes into these images and uses them beyond what they're actually useful for. And he'll use known artifacts, and I shouldn't have used the term artifacts. He uses known inaccuracies is also the wrong word. I'll just say artifacts, as in like compression artifacts. So if you were to download a movie, you know, a full-length movie back in the day when it was still sort of maybe quasi-legal, you know, and you have this full-length, two-hour-long movie that's 200 megabytes on your computer and you watch it, you'd probably notice that it's really blocky in areas, and the you get like frames sort of seeming to drag because the refresh rate wasn't good. And that's because it was so compressed that it has this known type of compression artifact. A lot of the different analyses that Richard has done over the years, especially in claiming that there was a city at the South Pole of the Moon that was bombed by NASA with the L-Cross mission a few years ago.
Right.
His entire analysis there was based on known JPEG compression artifacts. And JPEG is very, for those who don't know, is a very common image format that has this kind of blocky, usually very colorized artifacts that pop up in images that have been JPEG compressed. And you basically, if you go and look at these images that he's using, you can look at those, and if you deal with images a lot, you're like, oh yeah, that's JPEG compression. And he's pointing them and saying, these are pipes, and these are beams and towers. And it's like, well, the reason that you're getting regular geometry is because, yes, it was produced inside of a computer in a compression algorithm. Compression wasn't the case for this Viking stuff in this particular case, but it gets back to this, you have to know what the limitations of your data are before you can actually use them. And if in most scientific training, at least in the hard sciences, and by hard, I mean more basic physics type, as opposed to what we would call the soft sciences, which are more like psychology, archaeology. Well, I would still say archaeology is a hard science. But so a hard science like physics, for example, you take entire courses, like an entire semester in college and graduate school, on just understanding errors and uncertainty and the limitations of your data. And the problem is that this Viking data was limited for the kind of analysis that Richard wanted to do, especially when you're limited to just a few images at a few lighting angles. And when you go to different lighting angles that we were able to get with Viking, or to the much higher quality images in terms of not only just it's a better quality picture taken with a CCD as opposed to literally almost photographic plates, when you go to these higher quality and higher resolution where you could image a dinner plate, like we have cameras with telescopes around Mars right now that can, where a pixel is the size of my keyboard, and I have a full keyboard sitting in front of me. These are really incredible cameras. And when you look at this stuff with those cameras, which is actually image 5 on your site, this stuff that looked like one thing in these lower quality, lower resolution images with specific lighting angles no longer look like that. And so as a scientist, as an objective person, I would go in and say, okay, well, that means that this one image where it looks like a face is just pareidolia. It's a trick of light and shadow to make it look like a face. In all of these other images, it doesn't look like a face. And no, there are literally dozens of other images of this region, and pretty much none of them show a face unless you do some very odd types of image analysis that people have done and posted to the internet. People can do a search for face on Mars and find all sorts of stuff.
Right. And so everybody go to picture number 5. Now this is This says NASA JPL University of Arizona MRO high rise.
Yeah, so that's the NASA JPL U of A. Those are, so NASA paid for the mission, JPL contracted for the camera, and University of Arizona actually built the camera and operates the camera. So that's why you have all those credits down there. MRO is the Mars Reconnaissance Orbiter. It's still in orbit now, and HiRISE is the High Resolution Imaging Science Experiment, and that's the one that can photograph my keyboard if it existed.
Now, with this photograph, I can understand. If you take this and you rotate it and you get it upright and you squint your eyes and let your imagination go, you can sorta, I can see it. I can't
see where it came from.
You can see it, but you know why? Because that is what our brains are programmed to do, is to see a face in anything.
Well, so I've given a presentation a few times that includes a little bit of pareidolia, just as an example at the end. And I got this amazing image from a guy from the Rocky Mountain Paranormal Society, which operates out of Colorado, Brian Bonner. He gave me this image to use, and I can't say gave me because we gave the first version together at a conference. It's this amazing image. You tell people, so, okay, do you guys see the Elephant Man in this? And even the slide is labeled the Elephant Man. And you look at it and you squint and you're like, oh yeah, that looks like a face, you know, with a torso. And it looks like a weird nose. It looks like an Elephant Man, a man with an elephant face.
Okay, now you don't have to body slam it, okay?
Well, so then,
you don't have to go there.
you rotate it 90 degrees.
Right.
And it's a dog sitting right in front of a fireplace. It is not a person.
Right.
It's just, and still about a third of the audience, whenever I've given the talk and used that image, a third of the audience, I actually have to draw out the dog for them. Whereas if I had shown them the dog first, nobody would have seen the Elephant Man. They would have seen the dog rotated. So the fact that I had primed them to think that it's an Elephant Man, and they all saw it to begin with, and then I just rotated it and showed them what it really was.
Right.
They still saw the Elephant Man, even though that's not what it was. And the same is true with this face on Mars. We are all primed now. It is pretty much saturated popular culture. It is the pareidolia for Mars. We're primed to see that as a face. And I can definitely see in this image where and how you get a face and how that works out.
100%. 100%. But you know what's missing from this picture and from the earlier claims? Teeth.
Well, so then you get into the what can you do with the individual pixels?
What you can do with the pixels. That's right. That's right.
Yeah. I mean, so there are people out there, and I won't name names. I mean, Richard didn't brought up a lot, but he wasn't one of these people, although he used that person's claims. There are people who did very interesting analyses on that original and a couple of the original Viking images and claim to have brought out teeth, and that in the eye socket there was an iris and there was a pupil,
iris,
all of this other stuff. And it's like, I've looked at what they've done, and it's like you are looking at individual pixels, and at that point it's below the level of the noise. And I don't want to get into image noise unless we really have to, because it's a little difficult to explain. But it's just like, it gets again back to that. You've done an analysis and are reading into the data more than you actually can. At the very best, the most you can say at this point is there might be something there. And then when we get these higher resolution images, I mean, this image, I gave it to you to post on your website, is about 5% of the full resolution of this image.
Right.
Tiny part of this image.
Well, that's okay. That's a whole exactly. Yeah. Let's go to pigs.
At this point, it doesn't hold up.
Like, it doesn't
have better data. It doesn't hold up.
Now, and again, and the reason why, Stuart, for everybody that's just tuning in, by the way, this is Stuart Robbins from Pseudo Astronomy.
Yeah, Pseudo Astronomy.
Did I say Pseudo? See, you corrected me. Pseudo Astronomy.
It's kind of the name of my show. I figure I can correct you.
I've been corrected on that my entire life. Pseudo.
Sorry.
Anyway, pseudo astronomy. The reason why you are on this show. This is just for everybody tuning in. We are not here to debunk or debag or body slam anybody. That's not the point. The point is, and I've had emails have come in since we've started this show. This is why you need to have Hoagland on the show. He's got to present his side. And no, that's why he's not on this show. I don't want to hear his side. It's based on nothing. And this example, I want to, based on what you just said, let's go to the first, the ziggurat pick, which is picture number one, which addresses exactly what you were just talking about. So let's back up 2 minutes. Okay. This is a very, the ziggurat claim, but no matter who made the claim, we're not basing names. That's not what we're here for. But look at the original picture, AS 11-38-55-64. Okay, for everybody out there, it's picture number one in the gallery on the left-hand side. That's the original picture of AS-11. Look at what they are claiming, whoever is, the ziggurat. Now look at that. What if you were looking at this picture first out and just looking at this, you wouldn't see anything here but a lunar landscape. There's nothing there. Nothing. You can't imagine anything. There's kind of a, if you look, there's a Christmas tree cookie right in the middle. If you see that, see if that was green and had sprinkles on it, that would be a Christmas tree cookie. I can see.
There's pareidolia for you again.
Yeah, right. Exactly. So now when you look at AS 1138 blown up, which is on the top right, and there's three images here. Everybody knows what I'm doing. It says via the Lunar and Planetary Institute. So take a look at that picture. And if you squint, sort of, you can kind of see some geometry there that is being caused by, A, the angle of the photograph, the way it was taken. So you're looking at the edge of hills. And then also the shadows in that crater is causing some straight lines because of the resolution. That's the only reason why those are 90-degree angles. And if
you're also looking at it as if you're sort of looking out a plane and taking a picture of the distant horizon. So they were, yeah, this was from the command module. They're looking, you know, it's a very perspective shot.
Yeah.
Which is why, you know, otherwise the craters would be perfect circles.
Right, right. Well, would be perfect. Yes, exactly my point. And so, and then the shadows that you are seeing here are being forced into a certain pixelization that causes these parallel lines. And that's the key word, parallel, which indicates structure. So if you go to the bottom picture, which is the one that hit the web, and I'll never forget it, man. When I first saw that, I thought, there's no way. Really? This is on the... So the way that it's being represented down here by this gentleman, we don't need to say his name, but when you look at this, that looks freaking man-made to me. That looks like anything that I could defend with an army. It looks like a really cool fortress. You've got a Chinese-inspired central square there. I see it all. I could see the moat around the bottom of the walls. You know, I can see it all. I really can. But then when you look at what is really in the picture and you go up, you can see where it can be manipulated and turned into, but you know that it is not what is claimed. And that just to me, I'm sorry, it's just a lie. And that's why you are on the show. That, you know, people need to understand what they're really looking at. So I want you to explain how you got this, how they got this pixelization. Is it some type of Photoshop layer? Is it a filter that is being used? But how do you get from A to B to C?
This is one of those cases where I don't know how they did it originally. The origins of this image are very much in question. I mean, I'm talking about sort of the bottom middle one that says via the Call of Duty Zombies forum.
Right.
So this was...
is there any other... Okay, before you answer that, is there any other reference picture besides what is here? That's it, right? The only picture is AS 1138-55-64. And what we're looking at here, the final version of it, the final iteration, is still AS 1138 5564. Am I correct on that? There is no other images available to extrapolate this final image.
It depends on what you mean.
Well, is okay.
There is no other image that is this perspective.
Is okay. So we have picture A, we have picture B, picture C, right? Lunar and planetary, and then C is Call of Duty. So okay. What I'm asking is C Call of Duty? Is its progenitor AS11385564?
Yes.
Done.
Okay.
Thank you for coming on the show. That was great. No, I'm just kidding. But
I mean, 45 minutes.
What? No. Come on, Stuart. You're too easy. So listen. So honestly, I need everybody to understand if I'm not explaining it correctly. But picture number C, Call of Duty, is taken from picture B, which is AS11385564, and that's the misrepresentation. Am I correct? You just said yeah. Am I correct? I would need everybody to understand what they're looking at and what was represented to be real.
Yes, figure C, the one labeled Call of Duty, would have come from a version of figure A, the big one, AS11385564.
Shouldn't somebody go to jail for this? I mean, is that right?
Well, it depends.
I mean, ethically, no. I'm being facetious, but but there's a certain amount of ethic and morals. I mean, somebody is sitting around somewhere saying, hey, man, this would be really cool. Look what we can turn this into. You know what? Let's bang this out on the web and tell them that we just found a ziggurat pyramid. And let's run with this. Let's see how many clicks we get. You know,
it was a lot.
Yeah.
Especially after it was broadcast on some, various radio shows.
Yeah, and again, look, all of those, it's not all of those radio shows, mine included, my friend, should be considered entertainment only. Stop, you just stop right. You cannot go and start making claims on shows like that. There are shows out there that do claim that things are real. You know, this show is entertainment only and everything else.
With some real science, as long as...
Well, yeah. And my point on the show has always been, just come here and learn something. Just come here, spend some time with us, and walk away knowing that you've learned something. I don't want to change people's minds. I just want people to think. That's all.
Yes.
That's it.
And that is, to reiterate, especially for those just joining, that is my intent, is to at least present a more, what I would consider a more rational side to this, to various claims, and to have people then go off and do their own research, now knowing some of the other tools that they can bring to it that hopefully I've shown them how to use or talked a little bit about, to give them that more information, because in the end, I mean, you have to make your own decision about something. You can't just go off and take someone's word for it. You should do your own investigation. And my point is to bring some of those tools that I've learned over the past decade and a half of my schooling to bring it to the masses, to show you some stuff that you might not have been aware that you can do. And that was my intent with this whole lunar ziggurat thing, was, looking at this image that was presented as this is a real step pyramid. For those who don't know what a ziggurat is, it's just a step pyramid. People were presenting this as real, and I went and I did a basic analysis, and I said, for these various reasons, I don't accept this as a real thing. And people can go to my blog. I've written over 20,000 words on this lunar ziggurat thing, but one other reason that's very easy to explain why is to simply if you were to go to figure 2 on your site that I provided, there are other pictures of this region, and it simply doesn't show up. And there are pictures of not just by NASA spacecraft. I show in figure 2 one from NASA, but also then one from Selene, also known as Kyuga, or maybe Kaguya, which was a Japanese spacecraft. The Indian Chandrayaan 1, and I apologize to anyone who speaks Indian or whatever, Sanskrit, I guess that would be, they've also imaged the site. So has the Chinese with Shangji. And so it's kind of like, well, when your claim is based on one image that has very questionable origins, in this case, it was originally said, no, I found it on Call of Duty Zombies, and then it was said, no, actually, I found it in the 1990s. I just lost it and then found it again on Call of Duty Zombies. You know, when it's one image versus all of these other images, and then there are other reasons why I also say this is probably not real, then you should be questioning, okay, is this real or is this not? Now,
well, no, again, it's Stuart. Stuart, I'm going to interrupt and then I'm going to let you finish. But this is a really good point that needs to be driven home. And as a matter of fact, Eugene just tweeted this, and I'm sure you just read it, when he said that all NASA posts is blurry pictures. Eugene, what you need to understand, and take this the wrong way, if I want you to be offended right now. Listen to what I am saying. Which one of these two pictures is blurry? Is it the picture that we're expected to digest and believe is real, or the one that NASA is presenting is blurry? Well, there's only one answer to that. Look at the bottom. That, what do you mean? NASA has, if there's one claim that conspiracy theorists have against NASA, is that their pictures are too perfect. That's the one.
The way they get blurry is when people, you know, since we've named him already, and I apologize, Keith, but you know, when people like Richard Hoagland blow these images way up to beyond what they're supposed to be, and you're looking, when one original pixel is 100 pixels on your screen, yeah, they're going to look blurry. But in general, the only pictures that I've seen from NASA that are actually blurry are a few from Cassini when they didn't know what moon they were aimed at. And then many from taken by the Apollo astronauts because they didn't have the focus right. So, you know, NASA in general produces very sharp images, and especially the spacecraft that have been in orbit for the last decade or so, you know, except when trying to image through dust storms on Mars, every image is really, really clear. And, you know, I say this because I do this for a living. Like, I stare at images from NASA of the moon, of Mercury, of Mars, and moons of Saturn every single day. I have looked at tens of thousands of these images, and very, very, very few of them are actually blurry. Sorry, Eugene.
No, again, that's what I'm trying to say. You need to, with stuff like this, and the problem that we have is, had the original poster posted the Ziggurat Pyramid online, in addition to right next to the NASA AS-11 photograph at the same time, that's a different story. And you can go and make whatever claim that you want. But he couldn't and wouldn't, because everybody would look at AS-11 and go at 38, 55, 64 and go, dude, how do you get from this to this? Okay,
I'm not. There are claims that NASA airbrushed it and blah blah blah.
Well, so. Again, yeah. Okay. Make that claim with these two photographs. There's just no way.
Yeah.
There's just no way that was airbrushed. I understand. No, totally. And I'm almost tired of hearing that argument that NASA's doctoring photographs. Look, I may not believe that we went to the moon. Sometimes I question that, but the photographs are real on the moon. You know, I understand. And for somebody that wants to, you know, accuse me of not presenting this correctly or not being fair, or I need to choose a team, you know, and stick with it. Look, I'm just objective. And I'm open-minded, and I listen to all points. Okay, so go back. You said you needed to back up.
Yeah, so the claim about NASA airbrushing something, it crops up a lot in a lot of cases. So it might be worth, I say briefly, it probably take me 3 minutes to go through. It's a claim that would be incredibly difficult to actually do if you wanted to do that, and here's why. When you take a picture of a surface, very, 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 very rarely are you aimed straight down at it and you're looking at it as a flat surface. So what we do is we have software. One of them is called ISIS, which is, I don't remember what it stands for, but it's produced by the United States Geological Survey, and it's what we use to process spacecraft images. And it takes into account the camera geometry, how it was pointed, and the topography of the surface to correct for every single little distortion that we can in these images, so that it, when you've gone through the processing, it is as equivalent to looking straight down as you can. And this is just, you know, moving pixels around a little bit, and it produces its own artifacts that I'm not going to get into. But that's what we do. Then you get into, okay, well, that's fine. What does that have to do with anything? We have images of pretty much every spot on the moon and Mars, and a couple other bodies, but specifically the moon and Mars. We have images from multiple spacecraft, from multiple cameras, from multiple countries, from multiple lighting geometries, so depending on where the sun is, for multiple seasons, because Mars and even the moon sort of goes through quasi-seasons.
Yep.
And all of this stuff would have to be factored into your fake airbrush model, because you have scientists like me who actually go through and get, say, 7 different images of the exact same spot from different cameras taken on different days with different lighting angles with different resolutions, and we use them, and we would know if stuff doesn't look right. Like, if that teeny tiny crater is there in one image and isn't in another, we'd be like, what's going on here?
And to clarify what you're saying, and again, I need to clarify for everybody out there. Let me dumb that down a little bit.
Sorry.
Just stay with me. Every single country, every single engineer, every single spokesperson to the public, everybody everywhere would be involved in the greatest conspiracy ever, in that they are going back and airbrushing every single pixel and correcting everything so that everybody's output and input is exactly the same and resembles the other.
Exactly.
That is what you are saying. Not only that, Stuart, that is on that side of the fence. That's on the NASA conspiracy side, that they're airbrushing stuff. It also works for the other side. If you are presenting a picture of a step pyramid on the moon or Mars or Venus or Jupiter, pick your planetary, whatever, then it better be in everybody else's photograph. That same irregularity has to be everywhere else. That's it. You cannot say you have the only version of it, period. The progenitor is a great word, because you have to go back to the original source, and for people that don't understand, Stuart, you should be impressed. That's some pretty good vocabulary, huh? But everything's got to go back to an original. There's an original. There's a germ. There's an original source for all of this. There's a point source. It's got to be there. So if you're going to produce a picture like this, then damn it, everybody else better have photographed the same thing, because everybody's not against you.
and my point is that you would have to come up with that model and share it internationally, at least, I guess, in the 60s when we first had these spacecraft go up. You would have to have that model predicting the arbitrary resolution that we might get in 100 years of this area, and create that model and then somehow put that model into every single picture that you're airbrushing of every single site that you want to airbrush. And what I'm saying is that, to me, that is the extraordinary claim, as opposed to there is one image from a questionable site that appears to show a step pyramid. And it's just like, well, which is more realistic at this point? Is that someone, you know, there's this international, you know, and I do realize there are some people out there who believe this, that there's this international cabal that can create this and then factor it into all of these camera models, all of these lighting geometries, all of these varying resolutions from 100 meters per pixel to 100 millimeters per pixel, and share this internationally so all these other cameras will do it and keep this going 50 years, or there's this one image that has been modified by someone to show a pyramid. And to me, it's just like, well, to me, that's a no-brainer. It's the ziggurat is a hoax.
We still didn't go to the moon.
Yeah.
We still didn't go to the moon. I'm just messing.
I think that we'll just agree to disagree on that. Maybe if you have me back in the future, I'll be better prepared.
Just messing with you. Now, check this out. I have to ask. Did you see the the picture of the light emitting from the surface of Mars last week that went around the web?
Yes.
Okay. I'm going to ask your opinion. I want to know what you think you saw or what you think you see. Give me your best pareidolia response on that. But that what I'm not buying in that picture is the explanation, the official explanation, what the picture could be. And the reason for that, and I'm talking about excited cosmic rays, you know, charged cosmic rays. Why hasn't this been photographed all the time? You know, this is suddenly the one time that some kind of cosmic ray is blasting onto the surface and it's reflecting, whatever the excuse is or whatever it is. I'm not buying into that because it's never been shot before. It's like the elusive swamp gas of the 60s. Okay, that's kind of what I think the excuse is. Now, that's my opinion. I'm fascinated by the picture. I don't know what it is. I haven't made any claims to what it is. I can only tell you what it looks like. Looks like some kind of either gas emitting from the surface. That could be a possibility. It's being lit up in the sunlight. That's one. Or it could be a light. It kind of looks like a searchlight. You know, there's kind of a weird base to it where it's dark at the bottom. I don't know. I haven't made any claims. I do know it's not what they're saying it is. Because it's never been photographed before, and there, you know, it's not like they said this is an example of cosmic rays being lit up on the surface of Mars as photographed before in this photograph or in this photograph. You know, so what do you think it is? What it's a fascinating photograph, just taken, you know, as presented. It's pretty fascinating.
This is sort of where I go into, let me provide you the tools and the explanation that you might not have known about. You're actually incorrect. Cosmic rays are photographed all the time. And there are many examples from the NavCam. This was the camera that's on Curiosity that happened to take this particular image. There are examples of other NavCam images that have cosmic rays that no one has paid attention to until this particular image.
But do they all look the same?
So cosmic rays are, you know, these highly charged particles, highly energetic, that come through and just, you know, we have them on Earth. You know, they're cosmic rays. They make it through the atmosphere and into our detectors, because the way that the CCD works, the cameras work, is that they basically record photons by exciting electrons. Sorry to get technical, but that's about as simple as I can get it. Yeah, the photon hits and an electron is kicked up. Well, a cosmic ray is a lot more energy than a normal visible light photon. And so you're going to kick up a lot of photons, and so it's going to be this bright spot. And cosmic rays can come in from any direction, pretty much, although it's hard to get them coming through the planet itself. But
right.
So you have, you know, 180-degree field of view, effectively, for cosmic rays to come in straight at you or at an angle.
So the one that we're seeing here, it was lucky that it's at 90 degrees?
So then you get into possible other explanations. So I think what is the likeliest explanation that I've seen is that it was a cosmic ray, and then you have a blooming artifact. So I mentioned that you have the electrons get kicked up. If too many get kicked up, they effectively spill over into neighboring pixels. And that almost always happens along columns of pixels. And if you look at this image, this is along a column of pixels. And we see this all the time in telescope images that, you know, I've taken with normal CCDs, even astronomy grade CCDs. They've been hit by cosmic rays, and we see those cosmic ray streaks. And if they're really bright, then they can bloom a little bit going along these vertical lines. I also use, as I mentioned, Cassini images for studying Saturn's moons, and that particular camera gets blasted by cosmic rays in practically every single image I've seen. And some of them are dots, some of them are dots with blooming, some of them are streaks. And so the most likely explanation that I think for this particular example is a cosmic ray and or a cosmic ray with a blooming artifact. And I say that because it would be very hard for it to be a real feature and have only shown up in NavCam right. So the thing is that the NavCam on Curiosity has actually two cameras, left and right, and they both take a shot pointed in the same direction at the exact same time. And in this case, that bright few pixels only showed up in NavCam B, or yeah, the right one.
Yeah, the right one. It didn't show. No, it showed up in the left one. It didn't show up in the right one at that same moment.
Okay,
that's right. Or is it? Yeah, what?
Up in one or the other.
Yeah, one or the other. Yeah.
Yeah. So the point is the same: is that for it to be an actual feature, you would have to, for it to be an actual feature, you know, at least a few hundred meters away, based on the context, it would have to be an incredibly, almost like a laser pointer, literally aimed at that camera, for it to only have shown up in that camera and not the other one. And so, it's hard for me to think of something that would do that, natural or other, or natural or artificial, except for these types of image anomalies that we get, in this case, cosmic ray. Another thing that some people are talking about perhaps as an issue is an unaccounted for light leak. And, the whole thing is self-contained, but if there's a teeny tiny pinprick of light, it could get through. I don't think that that's likely, but I don't know enough about the cameras to say anything else. So, it's kind of one of those, we don't know, but let's list all of the possibilities that there can be, natural or artificial,
right,
and see what is most likely given the data that we do have. And then, I guess your point of view or worldview factors in a little bit. If you think that there were ancient aliens on Mars or some intelligence there today, then this perfectly fits in with that. And it could be a very sharp glass spire, perhaps, that's aiming, is reflecting sunlight directly into that camera and not the other one. Or if you're coming from, not to use it as a dirty word, because I don't think it is a dirty word, but if you're coming from the more skeptical, the more critical thinking viewpoint, and where your threshold for evidence is higher, you'd say, well, this is also consistent with a cosmic ray event. And so for me, that's where I sit on this. And there are examples of cosmic rays from these images. It's just they're a little bit more rare because of the processing that goes into these images. And also, you do have an atmosphere on Mars, even though it's really thin, as opposed to there is no atmosphere as Cassini is orbiting Saturn, as the other example I gave.
Well, I think it's the landing lights at the end of the runway for the capital city of whores. That's what I think. Me personally, that's what I get out of it. It's a joke, Stuart. Stuart.
One possibility. For me, that's less likely.
I thought you'd get that. I thought you'd get that. You of everybody.
I did get the reference.
Okay. Okay. All right. Man, I thought about that for at least 20 minutes.
Work it in, but I couldn't. So I just
went on. Now you said that there's other examples of this. Now, why haven't I may not have seen the other photographs, but why hasn't the other the other conspiracy theorist out there, why haven't they grabbed a hold of these images and why aren't they splashing all over? It seems like to me this is the first time we've seen this type of anomaly.
Well, for that you have to sort of figure out how exactly the news cycle works and how people. Well,
yeah, I understand. I understand, Stuart. I understand that. What I'm saying is, where are these other images? And could you send them to me?
I'll write it down, because otherwise I'll forget.
I'm totally hip on the news cycle, my brother. I haven't seen. To me, this is the first time, and it seems like a lot has been made of these pictures there's two, because it seems like it's the first time. That's all that I'm saying. If there's other images of excited cosmic rays bombarding the surface of Mars, and we have not seen those pictures before, and this isn't the first time and it happens all the time, so be it. I would love to see those pictures, and we can put this whole thing to rest. I think the picture is badass. I look at that and I go, explain this one. Somebody please explain this one to me, because I've never seen anything like it.
For me, even if it were completely artificial and it were, alien searchlights or something, my viewpoint is that I would I'm just kind of like, 50 years of space exploration, and that is the best.
Well,
that
it's
we
pretty.
Have
it's
is,
pretty.
You know,
it's
a spotlight and a few pixels in one image.
Yes, but for me, absolutely. Am I going alien? Am I going Martian? Am I going underground civilization? No, I'm not going there at all. I just want to know what it is. Could it? It could be something more extreme. Like maybe it's a Chinese. Maybe somebody else beat us there. Maybe it's something else. Maybe it's something that we left there and we never told anybody. It could be anything. I'm not going alien that extreme. I'm just saying that the picture is frigging fascinating when you look at it, and it's just like, explain this one away. Just please tell me what I'm looking at, because what I'm seeing, if I relate this to anything, speaking of, it's not a case of pareidolia.
No, it's not,
because you look at that and you know what it is. It's a beam of light.
They are bright pixels. That is what they are. And
yeah.
What does that mean?
Is it coming or going? And to me, it looks like it's going. So the cosmic ray explanation doesn't make sense. It looks like it's going from the surface up. It doesn't look like it's coming down. That's just the what. I don't think that's a play on my eyes. I just think that's what I'm looking at. I just want a good explanation. And and it sounds like you probably don't know either.
I don't think anybody knows.
Right.
It's again listing the possibilities and then deciding which is most likely.
And I think it's fascinating. Okay, hey, let's get back to the pictures before we run out of time. I want to let's go to the ziggurat in picture number two, and this is absolutely fascinating to me. So this is the same area as AS-1155, correct?
Yes.
So on the left, and I just want to be very, very clear, on the left in the lower, in the green square, in the lower part of the square, that the large, the shadow from the crater. And then right above it is that little tiny little crater, which would be at 9 o'clock, right? Okay, right there. That area is the claimed ziggurat. Am I correct?
It's really hard to tell in these different views. So what you're looking at is, yeah, so you see a very, the largest sort of depressed crater in the lower left,
yes,
quadrant, and then there's one above that, sort of at the 10:30 position, and then there's sort of one between them at the crease on the left side, as you said, to the 9 o'clock position.
Yes,
that is where the ziggurat is, and it would help probably the listening audience, if they're following along at home, to pull up that and the third image, because the third image was done by a guy who reads my blog, goes by the name of Gone to Plaid, Spaceballs reference.
Gone to Plaid, nice.
Yeah, so he did a great illustration showing how you go from looking straight down on it to how you go to the perspective shot of the AS-1138-5546 or 64. And so I'm looking at both of those right now, and so you can see sort of how things are matched up. And the point, though, of showing these two images is that looking at them, there is clearly nothing, at least nothing artificial in the sense of a lunar ziggurat. And to point out that the features correspond between the two. The craters match up as far as, you can tell.
Perfectly.
And this other
stuff. Yeah, absolutely.
And these are from different countries. So the WAC image is wide-angle camera on the Lunar Reconnaissance Orbiter, and the Selene image is the Kaguya Japanese spacecraft. So it's, different countries, different imaging apparatus, no ziggurat.
Yeah, and so when you look at picture number three, you have to digest these kind of like in order, and so you understand what's being represented here, both what is real and what is not real. But when you stair-step your way through this, and you go to image number three, and you start looking at this, and you're lining up the craters one by one, and going back and looking, And you can see where the shadow of the crater, and I'm talking about in picture number three. So when you go over on the left and you look at the purple rectangle that is highlighted, and you look at the big crater in the middle, that's the wall of the ziggurat. That is the wall. That is the moat. That is the entire image that they're claiming on. And then if you look behind, well, anyway, so you swing back over into the highlighted same area, and that is supposed to be the apex of the center of the ziggurat, and it's nothing more than the edge of a round crater. That's it. It's nothing else. There's nothing, and it's the key here. The key here for everybody and what they do need to swallow and get their head around, there are no parallel lines. There's not a one. There's not a parallel line here. And the pixel distortion that you get in the misrepresented picture of the ziggurat is because it's like you said, pixel distortion that is forcing those parallel lines. They don't exist. These are round craters, man. That's it. It's amazing how the eye can be fooled with a parallel. You can get a whole city street. You could get downtown Manhattan if you wanted to out of some of these with, you know, with low resolution pixel distortion. You'd get city blocks. You would get really nice right angles. So, okay, now let's go down before we do start to run out of time. Oh, before we do run out of time, there's one thing I need you to explain to me. And talk to me like I'm 4 years old for a second, okay? And explain this to me so I can use this knowledge for the rest of my life. How is longitude and latitude figured? There's got to be like a base zero. For instance, you're in Boulder, Colorado, right? You're in Denver. Let's just say you're in Denver.
Close enough.
Okay, all right. What is the longitude and latitude of where you are at? And where is zero? There's got to be a zero. Is there a zero that everybody agrees upon?
Yeah, so latitude is, usually very easy to describe. I mean, it's the equator. So you would first go to the rotational poles and say, okay, well, that's where the poles are. That's plus or minus 90 degrees, and halfway between them is 0 degrees. That's the equator. And then
stop. Yeah. You just completely lost me. Okay.
Sorry.
I get the equator. Okay. So then you have the degree off of the equator, correct? All right. That's what it's based on. So I'm assuming that I'm right. I'm slowly getting a grasp of this. But so if the equator is zero, then and that's latitude, correct?
Yes.
Okay. So longitude, when you're talking about the point of I don't have anything in front of me to give an example. I don't know what the latitude and longitude of Los Angeles is. I don't. But if you move it along the point of latitude, doesn't the angle of longitude change? If you measure it from right below where Los Angeles is, would that be 90 degrees? And then you can move it out from there and change it to 15 degrees if you went far enough around the Earth. So I don't understand how it's so firmly calculated. And based on that, with Mars, who has determined where the starting point is there? Because any number could mean anything. Am I right? Do you understand what I'm trying to say?
I'm not entirely sure exactly where you're going, so I'll try to explain latitude in a different way, perhaps. Latitude, so you have a circle. It's 360 degrees in any direction, basically, to go around it all the way.
Right.
And so, you know, you can approximate a planet as a sphere. So you can go 360 degrees around north to south. We'll leave out how you define that at the moment, or 360 degrees around the other way. And so what we do is we observe, you know, how a planet is, or, you know, even how the Earth is rotating. And we can see, you know, where the poles are. And so we sort of know the endpoints, and we can also, I guess, you know, tell where the equator is halfway between that. And that's not saying it in a different way. So
right,
I apologize.
Right. No, I
but
get
we,
it.
You know, early on, we measured that with the sun. You know, you have the equinoxes and the solstices and angles, you know, that don't have enough time to go into and not the inclination to go into. Those can tell you, you know, basically exactly what your latitude is based on the sun and based on measuring things out. And as you know, the lines of latitude are nice in the sense that if you're going due north or due south, they are evenly spaced with distance. So you know, a change of 10 degrees north or south latitude, it doesn't matter if you're going from 40 to 50 or 0 to 10, that is the same distance.
I got you. Okay. Okay.
Longitude is completely arbitrary where you define zero. On Earth, it's some observatory, I think, in Greenwich, because it was defined back, I think, when England basically was the, you know, the master of the seas. And so that was 0 degrees longitude. And figuring out where everything was longitudinally was very difficult to do for centuries. And I mentioned 2 hours ago, I think, there's this excellent book out there called Longitude, where it goes through how do you actually do this on the planet when you, you know, can't view it from space and simply hold up a ruler and say, okay, well, that's an even amount and that's
right.
an even amount and
right.
so that's 10 degrees.
Well, and plus you'd have to have a consensus with all the different civilizations out there, which there was no communication.
Right.
Where
so,
there
you know,
would be a basis.
Everyone did it their own way.
Right, right, right,
there
right.
needed to be some sort of standard. And for some reason, England won out. And I'm sure Wikipedia could give you more of the history on that. But let's get to Mars. On Mars, it was, you know, and other bodies. There, on Mars, I think it was back in the early days of exploration, either with Mariner or Viking, it was basically people picked a feature that was sort of close to where people had drawn it in the, you know, they picked their favorite scientist in the past where they had made their map of Mars and based on telescope observations and said, that's going to be where we define zero. And then when we had much better imagery, you know, 15 years ago, they had to refine it with a different feature. And I think the new definition of 0 degrees longitude on Mars is some like teeny tiny crater, which is a certain distance from the old crater that used to be defined as 0 degrees longitude. And all of this is basically codified by the International Astronomical Union. That is, you know, whether or not you're a member, I'm not a member, but it basically was set up to be a bridge for all of the astronomers from all the different countries. Even during the Cold War, the Russian scientists talked with the American scientists through the International Astronomical Union to decide on these sorts of standards. And for Mars, we have it pretty much set out. So everyone uses the same coordinate system, so we all know what everyone else is talking about. On other objects, it's actually much more controversial. The team that was in charge, or is in charge of the Vesta spacecraft, which Dawn spacecraft that imaged Vesta, was in orbit of Vesta for almost a year and is now on its journey to Ceres. That team fought with the International Astronomical Union on how to define not only longitude, but also latitude.
What is the general consensus? What is that? What's the name of that one crater that we're calling zero?
I have no idea, actually.
That's fair enough. And Keith, I'm going to ask you right now, Keith, you can respond to this. If you want me to read this on the air, I will. So you better tell me right now. Let's see how quick
someone
you
someone hate me already?
No. Keith just typed something. I don't know if he's being serious. And so before I read this, what is Cydonia? Just what is the face? What degree is the face?
Very roughly 45 degrees north, 40 to 45 degrees north, something like, I think about 10 degrees west.
Okay. All right.
Give or take 10 degrees.
Okay. All right. So Keith, there you go. I'm not going to read what you just typed. I love it. So, based on, because nobody has, there isn't anything firm yet on Mars. Any claims to any degrees of longitude and latitude, well, not latitude as much, but longitude, are open to anybody's interpretation?
Well, not on Mars. On Mars, it's pretty much set, and we all use the same coordinate system that was defined by the IAU and revised back in 2002, I think, based on the laser altimetry that we have. So this is a laser was in orbit, and it shot a beam down, and measuring the time it took to get the beam back, we figured out how far it was and could calculate various things about the planet. But when we get to these objects that haven't been as studied nearly as much, like Vesta, for example, and it was actually a really big issue because the main place where people not on the team can get the images once they're released to the public, they require that the images be in the International Astronomical Union's coordinate system. And since the Vesta team, or the Dawn team, refused to do that for a while, it meant that we couldn't get the data because it was something as stupid as trying to figure out where we set 0 degrees longitude. So to recap, latitude is based on the rotation of the planet, and there is no way to change, that is degrees latitude. Now, whether you say something is a north or south latitude, that's something they're running into with Pluto right now, figuring out what's north or versus south. But lines of latitude are based on the rotational axis. Longitude, you can divide it into 360 degrees, but where you put 0 degrees is completely arbitrary. And just by international treaty, I think, it's at, I believe, an observatory in Greenwich, England for Earth. For Mars, it was this feature based on a map that was close to where people had defined it before. And then when we got better imagery and better data, they shifted it slightly, so things sort of still lined up right. But, again, by convention, we sort of now all use that system just for ease of communication, so that if I tell you, okay, I want you to go to 50 degrees north by 30 degrees east, you can go and see what feature I'm looking at, and it's going to look the same on your map as it does on my map.
I was just sent a picture, and I knew about this. I was going to try to emailing it to you quick enough before the end of the show, but unfortunately, we are there. But it's that famous picture that Curiosity took, the rover, of the pump. The famous pump picture.
Was that number 9?
Yeah, with the with the pipe sticking out of it. And I wanted to. We were talking about this earlier today, Keith and I. What do you make of this? I mean, certainly it looks, and this isn't pareidolia. It just looks like something man-made, or not man-made. It doesn't look natural. There's something to this.
Well, so that actually is pareidolia. That's where you see something and the picture actually is oversampled, meaning that you've basically taken one pixel and blown it up to several pixels. But I do agree that that particular image looks weird and suggestive of maybe something. And
yeah, it is. It is.
I've looked at it, and the answer, you're not going to like it, is I don't know. It's interesting. What I would want is a higher resolution image. And I do know that, and again, since we've named him so many times already, when Richard presented this to Art back for the I think the first show that he was on for the Dark Matter, when he showed this, he did say that it was true color and that everything in it, like the blues in it and another picture that he showed, were true color, which I know is wrong. And there is not nearly enough time to get into that now. But basically, there is no such thing as true color. It's all an approximation. And that particular image was false color.
Okay.
But in terms of the feature itself.
Yeah. We got a roll. Stuart, yeah, we managed to pull this up to the very end of the show. I'm going to roll the music now, and I'm just going to get to credits. Will you come back on and just hang out with me for another night, and we can do
I'd
this
be
for
happy
real?
To.
I mean, this has been great fun, and I hope that we offended everybody out there, and I want everybody to just go and learn and and that's my point with all of this, always.
And don't take my word for it. Do your own investigation.
Absolutely. We're out of time. They're going to cut us off. We're signing off. Time's up. Show is over. I didn't even get to credits. Thank you, everybody. Thank you, Stuart. And I'll talk to you soon. I'll shoot you an email tomorrow. Thank you, Stuart.
All right. Thanks.
Good night, everybody.
Wow, 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 wow